And you, oh my God. Happy Friday, everybody. And welcome to Saki Speakeasy. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Hoocha. Let me clear the tears from my eyes because listen, these niggas is crazy. Talk about, I ain't never seen a one knee twerk before. I told y'all I'd be over here putting in work, damn it. My intro be on, baby. I be getting it. Do you hear me? And to have somebody make fun of me, how dare you? All right. Anyway, thank y'all for giving me a bit of your most precious commodity, your time. Y'all do me a favor and please love up on Love Jones for me. And please make sure that you like the video on your way in. And don't be afraid to drop in the chat box and say hello. A one leg twerk. You got your damn nerves. If you enjoy yourself while you're here, please consider subscribing to the channel, making sure to click the notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on an opportunity to chill with us when the speakeasy is open for business. I'm sorry, y'all. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. Thank you so much for subscribing to the channel, and I hope you find a reason to stick around despite my fucking shenanigans. And welcome back to my wonderful returning sippers and speakers, better known as the Speakeasy Backyard Gang, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thank you for coming back one more time to love up on your girl because I am addicted to the way that y'all love on me. All right. One knee twerk, child. Just try to chew around the glass, okay? I'm sure I missed a couple spots. Just watch out for the glass. Hey, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you so much for being here, little sis. I appreciate you. Hey, Shakayla, welcome, darling. First sipper and speaker through the door, honey. She said, I'm early, so I'm on time. All right. Thank you for being here. Hey, Tiffany, welcome, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. And you too, TJ, welcome, welcome. Hey, Naja. Hey, November. Welcome back, Tamika. What did she say? I've been listening to you all day. I had to get caught up on the last book and two others. I'm now on pistol. Oh, okay. She said, and whatever you about to read. Oh, Lord. Okay. Well, thank you for being here, darling. And thank you for catching the replay. I appreciate you. Hey, Milan. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Hey, wifey. Oh, resident troublemaker on deck. Hey, church lady. Child, listen. Cute shorts. Oh, sassy for Friday, honey. Watch out. You're supposed to be sanctified, child. Not sassy. Child, listen, it starts with S, so I guess. All right. Hey, little mama, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey, and you too, Danielle. Good evening, Kiana. I hope I'm saying it right, child. I know I've seen you in the replay. And yes, all is well, always. All is always well around these parts. And welcome. Thank you for being here. Hey, Marva. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. Happy Friday to you. Hey, Nye. Welcome. Hey, Unisha. Thank you for coming on through, child. Welcome. Welcome. Hey, Jan. Welcome. Child, listen. Me and this one knee be doing it. Do you hear me? I got a little dip still left in my hip. Just a little bit. Just a little bit, child. I can't dip all the way down. You know, I ain't dropping low and sweeping the floor with it. But, you know, I can pop a hip or two. Watch out there now. Lord have mercy. All right, let me keep on going here. Y'all just be talking and talking and talking. What you saying? Hey, Nora, where I skip over you at? Hell, this the first time I done seen you. Child, listen, but well, I love you too. All right, we're going to keep on going. But welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Melly Mel is in the building. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Now, where the hell is she talking about I skip over her? Child, don't you be putting that on me now. If I'd have saw you, where you at? Let me see. I'm going to skip over you at. Where's she at? I don't even see her. Oh, she right. Oh, child, listen. Okay. You said, hey, I didn't see my name or auntie. I didn't see auntie till you said it right here. Y'all listen, I told you I'd be going. I'm in a hurry. I'm ready to read this damn book. I ain't got time to be. Y'all be speaking to each other and shit and setting up dates and phone calls and shit and asking about plan Bs and shit. I be looking for my name because that's the stuff that pertains to me. I be trying to stay out of y'all business until I rewind the tape later on after the speakeasy closed, and then that's when I see. Hey, Sean, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome. Yeah, child. If I don't see my name or auntie, that's what I be looking for. Saki or auntie. If I don't see that, baby, I'm scrolling clean past it. Y'all didn't come here for me to be reading the damn comments. Y'all came here for me to read the book. So make it easy for me. Make it easy for me, child. All right, let me get this timestamp for this synopsis. Y'all, this book better be damn good, else I tell y'all, I'm going to really be disappointed. I'm not in the mood to be disappointed, child. It's the 19th. Y'all do know I do everything early, right? Catch, if you know, you know. Whoops. All right, here we go. Wait a minute. No, sweet November. Girl, I hope not. Do you hear me? Child, listen. They better not be November. If you done jinx this damn book, Lord have mercy. Don't you jinx this book, girl. Don't you do it. You gonna get a whooping. All right. Wait a minute. So we letting the timestamp count down, y'all. Got a little bit more. About 5 more seconds. Well, 7. 5, 7, same fucking thing. How about that? All right, this better be good, child. That's all I got to say. Why is this doing this? All right, today we're reading The Twin by Smokey Moment. And the synopsis reads, a secret amongst brothers, a bond between twins with no boundaries, and an innocent request that changes their lives forever. The Langston brothers are New York's best prime real estate. Niles and Noah are the handsome and sexy identical twins of a wealthy investor. They're poised to take over their father's lucrative financial firm. Life is good, and they have the world at their fingertips. What could go wrong? What the Langstons want, the Langstons get. But when one brother asks the unimaginable, the scandal opens the doors to a steamy love affair, one that should have never happened. He scrambles to undo what started out as an innocent request and realizes that it's not so easy. Love is specific and it is powerful, something he overlooked when he thought two people could come together with no lasting effects. Things unravel fast, very fast. What happens when two brothers set out on a journey they didn't see coming? When an innocent request turns into a love affair with disastrous consequences? Read along in this tantalizing story about a second chance love. When circumstances and the burning desires between two people meant to be together complicates an already complicated situation. When a second chance love is really still the first chance. A powerful story of money, love, lust, sex, betrayal, and enough secrets to threaten everything the brothers fought hard to keep hidden. A second chance love that almost wasn't. All right, well, I tell you what, with a synopsis like that, goddamn you, it better be fucking good, Smokey. All right. We are going to see. All right. Who this is? I don't even, hold on. Oh. Hold on. Girl, why is this thing bouncing around? All right, here we go. There we go. Dang.
Here comes the money.
Here we go.
Money talk.
Here comes the money.
Thank you, Sean, for the tip. She said, for love you, auntie. Love you too, boo. Thank you for the tip, darling. I appreciate you. All right. Let me, Okay. So that was telling me somebody wanted to get into the you dig over there. All right. Okay, there we are. Okay, so let me see if anybody else came in, y'all, so we can hurry up and get started. Because listen, okay? All right. So, okay, child, listen. Right. Hey, Miss Pretty. Welcome, boo. Happy Friday. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Hey, Missouri. Child, you in here, girl? Welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome. Welcome. What the hell y'all got going on here? All right. Okay. Now, let me get this time stamp here. I don't know if y'all can see y'all. My whole screen is dark. Let me refresh this damn thing. Child. All right, I ain't got time. The other day, it was StreamYard. Now, I guess today, YouTube said, fuck it, it's Friday, and let's just fuck it up. So that's what it's doing. Hey, Cleopatra, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Chapter 1, Not So Ordinary Lives. Wall Street was busy. Noah Langston hated the financial district. The corporate men and women with their plastered-on smiles and questionable business ethics were, at minimal, disheartening. He had many sleepless nights trying to figure out another way to make his mark. Following in his father's footsteps was not something he saw himself doing. Not exactly. He wanted to work with money, just not at his father's firm. I'm sick of this shit, Noah fumed as he crossed at the light. He accidentally bumped into a man, then apologized and continued walking towards his father's firm. He ranted at times loudly as he spoke with his twin brother over the phone. This is it, Niles. Seriously, I'm sick of the games. The head trips, he fumed. Niles sat on his couch listening to Noah's latest protest. His head down, his eyes closed. He sighed. The drama was too much. Usually, he could deal with the clashes between his brother and father, but not this morning. He had just popped 2 aspirin. He was feeling the after effects of several shots of tequila. He was glad he was not there. He was supposed to be. But a night of partying with his new female friend had his head in a weird space. It wasn't a hangover, but it was close. Noah, man, come on. Why do you even entertain him? You going over there to confront him. And then what? He'll still be your father. When you wake tomorrow, he'll still be the man that gave you life, the man that raised you, the man responsible for you not wanting for anything, Niles stressed. No, man, you got it wrong. One more move and I will disappear. He won't ever see me. I don't need him. Not anymore. I haven't for a long time, Noah said. Niles didn't understand how their father, George, got under Noah's skin. It was all so simple to him. When their father pushed, he moved out the way. He didn't try to push back. One could break themselves against the brick wall known as George Xavier Langston. He was tough as steel, with a soft spot for his immediate family. It was all words. George liked to hear himself talk. When it came to his children, they were adults and it was a way of feeling in control, even though he really wasn't. But Noah had tired of it. His mind raced. He rehearsed how he wanted to address the man who had been in the driver's seat of his life, a man who had to control everything around him. Noah was done. His 30th birthday was approaching. The control of his father over his life had ended. Or so he thought. It was hard to say. His father was still making efforts and money was still being deposited into his account. Well, hell, when they still giving you money, sir. When they giving you money, you got to shut the fuck up, I guess. Break out on your own. Start OnlyFans, nigga. Send some foot pics or something. I don't know. And money was still being deposited into his account. A trust with plenty of zeros behind it. The money made Noah feel obligated, and he didn't want to be. This was his life. Gone was the shy boy who listened to every word and followed every command. Noah wanted to make his own contribution to the world, not stand on the shoulders of his father's success. He was brilliant in his own right. He didn't see himself living under his father's strict rules. Life was meant to be explored, enjoyed. Knowing oneself and then living in your truth were the ingredients to a successful life. It was all so simple for Noah. Money could be made. If you lost it, you could make it 10 times over, but not your soul. What does one do when they've lost their essence, when their character is out of alignment with their normal compass? One might as well live like animals. And if you live like that way for too long, how would you get back to being human again? These were questions Noah didn't struggle with. He had the answer. He had already defined his character. His principles were intact. He was at his father's firm to set the record straight once and for all, a battle he was sure wouldn't be over. But he was in it for the long haul. He would do battle with anyone trying to run his life, a trait he inherited from his father, stubbornness. "Hi, Noah," the secretary greeted as he walked through the doors of his father's investment firm. She was all smiles with the son of her wealthy Forbes-listed boss. His smooth skin, chiseled features, and perfectly groomed facial hair caused plenty of women to take notice, but Noah was business as usual, and unlike his twin brother Niles, he kept flirting down to a minimum, especially when at the office. Not that the secretary didn't look ripe for a pounding or two. Not a pounding or two, just two. It just wasn't his forte. He liked to be in committed one-on-one relationships. Noah walked towards his father's office. His brother held the phone, listening to him breathe. "Noah, turn around. Leave. This can only end badly. You already made your point. You already got your own shit going on. Why go there and upset him and ultimately upset yourself in the process?" Niles asked. "Because he's telling people I'm marrying that bitch. I guess this is his way of forcing my hand, getting me to consider it," he said in a near breathless voice. He hadn't caught his breath from his sprint to his father's office, and now anxiety had him stressed even more. Noah could see his father's door was slightly ajar. He could hear him on the phone. George Langston always made his presence known. Noah felt sorry for the person on the receiving end of the conversation. His father could be brutal. He looked around. He nodded at a woman. She looked startled. She was obviously new. This was George most of the time. He shouted his way through $500 million. She would need to get used to it. It wasn't such a bad deal. The saving grace for most employees was his generosity. The bonuses were huge, and they were consistent. Sent out twice a year, one in June and the other at Christmas. Many of the seasoned employees had already figured him out. His bark was worse than his bite, and he rarely fired anyone. Most employees were longtime Langston financial team members, happy to be there. And their feet were planted firmly on the freshly carpeted floor. "Noah, man, what's up? Haven't seen you in a while," an employee greeted. Noah recognized the account executive. "Tom, yeah, it has been a while," he replied. Niles sighed. He could hear Noah talking to one of their employees. It was apparent that his brother hadn't heard a word he said, evident by the fact that he was still there. "Noah, who is that?" Niles asked. "Tom," he quickly said as he continued his conversation with him. Tom made a face that looked towards George's office. Noah shook his head. "He's been at it all day. We're basically just trying to stay out of his way," Tom noted. Noah understood. He lived his life staying out of his father's way. As the two men spoke about the market and trends in buying, Noah couldn't help but turn his attention away from the man. His father was still in a heated conversation with someone. The tone and pitch of his voice resonated through the hall. "Niles, look, I'll call you back. And no, I'm not turning around and leaving. I have something to say. I'll call you when I leave here." Noah hung up and made his way to George's office. He was ready for the man who controlled the world, or at least attempted to, and the person he was arguing with would have to take a back seat. And it's a break in the chapter. Child, listen. So Noah apparently is an out of control one, but we don't know if Noah is the one that's dressed in the suit or in the fucking, you dig, in the hoodie. Lord, all right. I don't even know who the fuck, okay, got Creole Patra, hey Buns, welcome darling, thank you for being here, let me see, who else, hey Demisha, hey girl, did you get any sleep last night? I see somebody missing, child, maybe they resting up. Child, listen, but we already know he gonna come for his little yeah. Wherever she at, that's where he gonna be at. He'll be in here directly. Keep your eyeballs open. Noah kept a steady pace to the corner office. It was large enough to be a studio apartment. He felt stressed. He didn't look forward to the conversation he was sure would not go well. His father was unwavering when he wanted something. He was a man who built an empire on negotiations and persistence. It was no surprise George Langston was rich. People with his traits usually found their way to the top. He was the owner of a highly successful investment firm. Langston Financial was at the top of the food chain. He started from nothing when he owned his first office, and now, 20 years later, his company was one of the top firms with satellite offices in several major cities. He had just returned from the grand opening of his newest firm in downtown Detroit, which was opening on the heels of two other new locations, one in Atlanta and the other in Dallas. George Langston was unstoppable. "Hey, Noah, what's up?" another employee greeted as he shook his hand, stopping to engage in small talk. The employee was surprised to see him there. Noah wasn't one to visit. The employee originally thought he was Niles, but his attire was too casual. "Okay, so Noah is the nigga, and Niles is the Carlton Banks of it all. All right, so we got nigga Noah and and nerdy Niles." All right, so now we know what's up. All right. So his attire was too casual, something that distinguished him from his twin, Niles. "Nothing here to speak to my father. No, to my father. Sorry, I thought I was about to say family. How's business?" he asked. The man told Noah he had just turned a huge profit investing in some bonds and mutual funds for a large client. Noah smiled. He understood the man's excitement. It was a powerful feeling, understanding money and markets, something not everyone could comprehend or was able to do with any long-term success. Trading took skill, and only the best made a great living from it. Noah congratulated the man, and the two promised to catch up later. He needed to keep his conversations brief. He didn't want to be there any longer than he had to. Noah neared the door. He watched as a man with a camera passed him by. The man was there to get a few more shots of George alone. He smiled and nodded at the man. Noah had been his mischievous self. The family had sat down for an interview and photos with Forbes the day before, a shoot he was supposed to partake in. The magazine wanted to take a picture to include with the exclusive interview of New York's powerhouse family. Absent from the family photo was Noah. "Come in, son," George said as he stood over his desk looking down at a spreadsheet. "Hey," Noah greeted, his hands in his pockets. He approached slowly. It seemed the patriarch was on a new mission to bust his balls every chance he got. He was growing tired of his father's incessant need to interfere with his life. He hoped this talk would set things right. Their arguments were getting more heated, and the fallout was lasting much longer. "What happened to you? You missed the photo shoot. Your mother, sister, and brother were here. Did you forget the magazine would be here? We took a family photo and you aren't in it. That was my second rescheduled appointment with them since you didn't show up for the first one. They're moving forward with the story and the picture they have," George complained as he shook his head in frustration. "Why must you embarrass me every chance you get? I know you did not forget. Anyway, too late now. What's done is done," he continued as Noah stood in silence. Noah paused before speaking. He wanted to avoid what looked like the opening to an argument. "I didn't forget, Pop. I was busy. And besides, you know I hate the public. I don't want to be in any magazine," he replied. George glanced at him. "You know, son, it wouldn't hurt you to take one photo, especially when you benefit from my hard work," he said. Noah scoffed. His father was now treading on shaky ground. Noah didn't ask his father for much. He had a trust fund, and whatever it didn't cover did not get purchased. Noah kept his spending under control, choosing not to live lavishly and only going for an occasional high-ticket item. But George was resentful. He was generous with his children. Noah was receiving a huge sum every month, and he would continue to receive it. All the Langston heirs would, so long as they played by his rules. But Noah had built his own fortune, using his trust fund to invest in the stock market. He was his own financial backing, an important feat since he was no longer willing to play. George was pushing his luck with his defiant son. Noah could be unforgiving. He expected his family to stay out of his personal and professional life, and he expected them to respect his decisions. He wasn't a child. He wasn't confused or torn. He was uninterested in money for power. He only cared that he had a home, a car, and enough not to go hungry. George had pushed him so hard growing up that he had turned his back on the family business, but it was in him naturally. He was more like his father than he cared to admit, and he was smart like him, mastering things like math and science with little effort. He was finishing up a second degree. His life was going just as he planned. The reason he took time out of his busy schedule to talk with his father, but a message left on his voicemail had him incensed. His father was at it again, pushing for him to help his twin Niles run Langston Financial and pushing for him to marry Jody Elizabeth Hawthorne, the daughter of Senator Morris Hawthorne, a family heavy in steel and oil. He was aggressive in his demands, and Noah pushed back with a vengeance. His father was asking the unthinkable: marry the daughter of a business partner, a woman he wanted nothing to do with. Noah was stunned. He had taken the woman out a few times to appease his father, even though the request, what the fuck? Sorry. Even though the request was implausible. He didn't love her. He wasn't even sure he liked her. Jody was a 29-year-old, spoiled and unbelievably rude young woman. She was arrogant enough to believe her beauty and family wealth afforded her the luxury of mistreating people, and the timing was bad for such a commitment. Noah was in the process of breaking off a hot and heavy romance with Gemma, whom he had been dating over the last year. He didn't see himself married to a woman who behaved so badly. If that were the case, he would stay with Gemma. She was a handful, to say the least. Noah knew it was a long shot. His father never really listened. He only knew one way, his way, and Noah was there to get his father to hear him loud and clear. There would be no wedding. Noah was proud of himself for making the trip to Langston Financial. He promised his twin Niles he would. Getting his father to side with him wasn't something he usually did. If his father didn't agree with him, he would simply stay away. Noah could disappear and cut off all contact for months at a time, but his mother begged him to talk to his father. And his twin Niles urged him to keep the peace. So here he was. Noah looked around at his father's over-the-top office. He wanted to get off the subject of the Forbes photo shoot. It was over, and he stood firm in his right to privacy. George was on his phone speaker talking to his secretary. Noah noticed the details of the office. His father had remodeled. Things looked slightly different. Every detail down to his pen holder was custom made. Noah waited patiently as he rolled his eyes at his father's opulence. He was embarrassed by his father's lifestyle. He thought it was a bit much. Children were starving in third world countries, yet he wrote with an ink pen that cost $2,000. George seemed preoccupied and glanced at his son, then pushed the button on his intercom. Faye, I need the spreadsheet for last month's final numbers. It should cover the 1st to the 15th of April. Then print a separate sheet showing a 30-day total. Right away, please. Thank you. George looked at his son. The silence between them was deafening. After a few minutes, he spoke. Do you own a dress shirt? Is it too much to ask that you come here dressed like you're going to run the place someday? He said. Noah sat back and crossed his legs. He pulled out his cell phone in defiance. His father had already pissed him off, and they hadn't even begun speaking about the main topic. Actually, I don't own a dress shirt. You have me mixed up with Niles, as usual, Dad. George sneered. He knew Noah was aware that he could tell the difference between his twin sons, even if they were identical. No, I don't have you mixed up. Buy a dress shirt. Noah became angered, but held it in. He wasn't there to be criticized. He was an adult, quite capable of picking his own clothes. He resented the comment. Dad, please, I came here to talk about Jody, but before you make your case, I need you to know that I do not love her. It's no secret. He shrugged, looking at his father and hoping that would be the end. He had no plans on entering into a loveless marriage, and he hoped his father understood. George was lucky enough to marry his college sweetheart. If there was anyone who should understand what he was saying, it should have been his happily married father. Noah, what will you do? You've been seeing her for several months, son. You two have been intimate. She believes you're headed to marriage. She said you mentioned it, and she has been out looking at dresses, trying to get an idea of what she wants to wear, his father said, as he reached for a pen and began to make marks on the spreadsheet. The door opened and his secretary, Faye, walked in. She sat the information in front of him, then picked up his old cup of coffee. Thanks. I need you to get Mr. Helms on the line. And can you get me a fresh cup of coffee and one for my son? He said. Sure, Mr. Langston, she said with a smile. George was a firm yet generous boss, and Faye made sure she was dependable. There was an executive secretary position posted, and she had her eye on it. It meant traveling and more responsibilities, and it also meant getting VIP reservations at all the private parties of George's inner circle. What are your plans? Your life isn't this complicated. It's an easy life. You're making this harder than it should be. She's a beautiful woman, George said. Noah sat shocked. His father couldn't be this insensitive to him. Attempt to plan his life for him while totally disregarding his plans for himself. Noah was ready to end the conversation. His father was again stepping on his toes. "Then you marry her," he shot back. George put his pen down. He gave a stern look. The disrespect was intolerable. "Watch your tone and what you say to me. I'm still your father," he replied. Noah sat forward, ready to stand and exit. "Dad, listen, I can't. I won't. I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but what you're asking is too much. And what has me so upset is the fact that you still continue to tell people her and I are getting married. Why are you going around announcing that to everyone we know? That is completely false. I never asked her to marry me. I don't know where she got that from. The truth is, I can't stand her. I absolutely will not be marrying her." George narrowed his eyes. It was always the same conversation with the youngest and most rebellious of his children. Noah was always vocal about what he would and would not be doing. George thought of his son as ungrateful and unappreciative. He asked of his son seemed minuscule. He was asked to marry the daughter of one of the wealthiest families in New York, a move that would make him important and influential amongst the political powerhouses, and George saw it as a chance to move towards the White House, a dream of his since he was a child, a dream not shared by his children. "Noah, I'm not sure you understand me. You're living a good life because of my hard work and dedication. I've paved the way so that you, your brother, and sister can have the very best of everything this world has to offer. I've asked for nothing in return. Can you indulge me on this one thing?" he asked. Noah shook his head and raised up slowly out of the chair. "I haven't given my answer on this, Dad." "Oh, I'm sorry. I have given my answer on this, Dad, but you're not hearing me. Why not ask Niles, huh? Because he won't indulge you, not even for a second, when it comes to who he lays with. Yet you ask me. Why? My answer is no, I will not." "Sorry," he said. George sighed. "I'm sorry too," he replied. He had warned his son that his leisurely ways and refusal to give anything of himself for the family's dynasty would not be tolerated. "Then you leave me no choice. Since you want to live on your own, then perhaps you should support yourself as well. You act as though you don't need any of this. I guess that Bentley, the Ferrari, and the boat is paying for itself," George noted. Noah scoffed at his father. He was now infuriated. George took another call as Noah stood steaming mad and ready to leave. Niles was waiting on him. They were supposed to meet up at an upscale lounge in a half an hour for drinks and a chance to unwind. He needed it. "Come on," he thought, as he walked to the window and looked down. The minutes ticked by as he waited for his father to finish his call. He looked out at the city line. He had a flashback. The office always brought back childhood memories. It was where he and his siblings ran around carefree as their father made million-dollar deals just a few feet away. The office that was like a second home. It was where George led by example and pushed his children to learn the business at an early age. He was demanding, stern, never allowing for much playtime. The Langston children had a tight schedule that consisted of homework, meals, and early bedtimes. The stolen moments at play were always abruptly ceased whenever they saw their father's office door open. Back then, George had much fewer employees, and his secretary doubled as a babysitter while his wife was away completing her master's degree. She would tell them to be careful, but otherwise gave them free rein until Mr. Langston's door opened. He was aware of his children's rambunctious nature, but they were expected to mind him, to show respect, to cease any behavior he deemed embarrassing or low class. Noah could see his father was ending his call. He wanted to finish the conversation uninterrupted and leave. "Dad, I never asked for any of this. The Ferrari was a gift from Niles for my 25th birthday. The Bentley, also from him on my 28th birthday. The boat was a purchase I made after 2 years, two of me weighing whether I wanted it or not. You have made it very clear that in order to play in your world, one must live by your rules, and I chose not to play. I am not a kid any longer, Dad. I'm a grown man. I'm not going to have you orchestrate a marriage of convenience with a woman I don't love. This is not a game of winner takes all. This is my life." Noah stared his father down. George felt disrespected again. Noah was standing his ground, and it was something that his father could not accept. He had controlled his children all their lives. He still had quite a bit of control over Nicole and limited control of Niles. "As you chose," George replied, looking as though he hadn't a care in the world. George Langston did not reach the top by giving in or stepping aside. If his son needed tough love to see the light, then tough love would be served in abundance. Noah shook his head. I feel sorry for you. Your children avoid you. Your friends dislike you. Your business partners wish you harm. How does it feel to be so hated? He said as he stormed out. George stared at the back of his son. He knew it would be at least 3 months before he would see him again, his usual disappearing time frame before he would come back into the fold. But George was wrong this time. Noah would be gone longer. And that's the end of the first chapter. Well, I, for one, we got niggified Noah and nerdy ass Niles. Oh, Lord. Okay. Let me see if anybody else came in, because listen, honey, okay? I don't even know what the hell is happening right now. So let me, okay, so Demisha came in. I was speaking to her. And then, hey, Cupcake, happy Friday, boo. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Let me see, child. Hey, Shakara, welcome, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Who else is a child? Boop, 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 boop. All right, I got all of these folks. I'm going, going, going. My tutor in the building, speaking to everybody. Let me see. There you are. Hey, Mo, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right. So let me get... the next time stamp. I don't know what's y'all, I don't know what to think about this book. I feel like what is he gonna ask his brother to do, right? Because that's all we really want to know. We really just want to know, what is he gonna ask his brother to do? I don't know. And is, how bad is it gonna be? Is he gonna be on some, hey, take my place type shit or no? And then is Noah going to double back and be like, yo, bro, I'm going to need my bitch back right quick. It's going to be too late. Already hit that, bro. That's mine. Oh, well. I got my time stamp. We just let me count down. I'm so fucking ignorant. Talk about I already hit that, bro. Demisha. Where your man's at, girl? Mm-hmm. That's what I need to know. I need to know where your man's at. Chapter 2, The Trip. Niles held his well-endowed manhood as he stared at the ceiling. Cheyenne lay next to him, naked and smiling. She had tried to sleep, but wanted him again. Are you awake? She asked, her derriere pressed against him. Yeah, he replied dryly. He knew Cheyenne wanted more. She always did. And he was beginning to feel smothered. They'd been at it all morning on the heels of multiple sex marathons throughout the night. He was tired. He had a lot on his mind. Cheyenne was pressing for a commitment and he was feeling the heat. Cheyenne turned over and ducked under the covers. Niall closed his eyes. He wouldn't dare stop her from taking him in deep. She had a deep and warm mouth, and she gave generously. He liked her. He enjoyed her company. He just didn't love her, and he wasn't sure why. She was beautiful, smart, successful, and she adored him. It made no sense, but it was his hard facts, and he needed to tell her. Niles didn't like to mislead, and he feared she was being misled. Well, by her damn self. If you done told her right out the gate that you ain't feeling it, so what the fuck? I don't know, but anyway, we gonna see. Cheyenne moaned softly. Niles' mouth hung open. Her intense concentration and sucking power had him ready to come. Shit, he said as he began to moan. He needed to come quickly. His twin would be there any moment. Damn, Cheyenne, he said as he grunted, then moaned. He grabbed her head and guided her mouth. She gripped tighter as she felt his penis pulsating. Come, baby, she teased as she used her hand to stroke him while she made circles around the tip of his penis. It was all he could take. Niles blurted out sounds as he grabbed Cheyenne and released himself in her mouth. His body jerked repeatedly. He raised up slightly, his mouth open, his eyes closed. His entire body reacted when he ejaculated. Cheyenne loved his energy, and when it was over, he dropped back on the pillow. Cheyenne got up and jumped in the shower. She loved the sounds he made, his smell, his taste. She was hooked. "Hey," Noah said as he walked through Niles's door. Niles lived like a king, being somewhat at his father's disposal had its advantages. He went along to get along with George and didn't experience the same level of intrusion and control by his father. Niles's personal life was a wild and carefree one. George knew better than to try to marry him off. He was not husband material at the moment, but it wasn't from lack of effort on George's part. He was waiting for his playboy son to settle a bit beforehand. He had tried, and Niles left the woman so emotionally damaged that George never tried again. She was the daughter of his business partner, and the bad breakup left tension between the families. George ended up losing a huge account because of it, but the stresses between father and sons was surface. Even for Noah, he still provided for them. He threw out verbal warnings that never came to fruition. Noah lived quite comfortably. There was plenty of money to go around. George put up a good front. The fact was that he spoiled his children. No matter what, they were still sent their trust money, and Noah had invested his and amassed his own fortune. So if George was serious and planned on cutting him off, it was too late. He was prepared. He, too, was wealthy. Niles and Noah were strong, independent men who despised any intrusion into their lives, and their father tried. He was attempting to groom them to take over his massive fortune and lucrative firms, but the brothers wanted to make their own decisions about how they would move forward into the future. Things had gotten so heated between Noah and his father that it caused him to become estranged. He seemed to be in a lifelong tug of war with his father. He decided to limit the time he spent with George in order to maintain a sense of self, and so he kept his distance, only indulging his father occasionally. Niles, the more outgoing of the two, indulged his father to a point. He was appreciative of his father's hard work, but like his brother, he wanted to pursue other options. Niles understood that the firm paid the bills, but his dream was law. He pictured himself helping others, a dream he pursued and made possible. He had gone to law school and had acquired the degree, but he continued working at Langston. George wondered if it all weren't just to prove he could do it. He never questioned him. He didn't want to push Niles's buttons. He was just glad his son worked at the firm, something Noah wouldn't do. Okay, so Niles is working at the firm as an attorney. And because he keep fucking random bitches and breaking their hearts, George won't ask him to do shit. But Noah is the loner who refuses to work at the firm. But because he's still his son, he gonna ask him to do it. Why are you gonna try to marry him off? Because he's a gentleman? No, he should go over there. And, well, I don't want him to be, you know, bopping bitches upside the dome and shit just to prove a point to his father. But like, just be like, listen, I'm a playboy. I just keep my shit on the low low. I got 4 kids out here that you don't even know nothing about. I ain't ready to get married. Like, anything to not have to marry some bitch you don't want to be with. Like, what the fuck? And what's up with her dumb ass being willing to do it? I guess she getting pressured by her raggedy ass daddy too. Anyway, let me be quiet. Niles was good at trading and investments, but he wasn't as skilled as Noah. Noah was a genius, but his father's controlling ways had kept him from joining the firm. Niles tried to get him to reconsider, but had lost the battle. And when he pushed too hard, Noah became distant from him as well. Niles even tried mending the relationship between his father and twin, but neither would concede. It meant giving up control, and that was an inconceivable thought for the both of them. And the one area of Noah's life that was not up for discussion or interference was his love life. He had been in 2 serious long-term relationships and several short love affairs, and none of his past relationships had him ready to commit on a more serious level. But this is why his father wants him to be the girl's husband, because he see that he'd been in 2 long-term relationships, right? I guess the bitches ain't too busted up and broken. If he think he a good example, you know, business-wise. But that goddamn Niles is the reason why him and his homeboy on shaky ground right now. Anyway, The most recent was a relationship with a woman named Gemma. Their strained and volatile union had him questioning what he wanted in his dating life. Gemma was a rebound love affair that he jumped into after ending a 6-year relationship with Melanie Strauss, the daughter of a restaurateur. But it was short-lived and had ended a few months earlier. He kept it under wraps for fear of his father's meddling ways. George was always trying to set him up, and Noah was always fighting for his independence. But true to form, after discovering that Noah was single again, George began pressuring him to date a young woman he knew, the daughter of a wealthy family, and Noah, under the pressure of both his mother and his father, reluctantly obliged. A decision of catastrophic proportions. Child, listen. You ready? Noah asked as he walked through the foyer. Niles was behaving strangely, grinning. Something was going on. Noah looked around. What's up? You look guilty or something, Noah blurted. Soon a woman emerged from the back. Oh, Noah, hey, Cheyenne said as she approached him and kissed his cheek. Noah looked at her as she walked away. She walked to the table to grab her things. Niles grinned and shook his head. Their silent visual communication understood by Niles' date. Cheyenne was no stranger to the Langston twins. The brothers were close. She knew she would be the topic of their conversation when she left. She originally met and was attracted to Noah, but his lack of enthusiasm made catching his attention difficult. Soon she sought Niles and knew just where to find him. He enjoyed the nightlife more than his brother, and one evening Cheyenne mysteriously showed up where she thought he would be. Noah didn't seem to mind. He was happy that his brother filled the void. Cheyenne was aggressive and he found her hard to escape. "Where you two troublemakers going?" she asked. "Out," Niles quickly replied. He had no problem keeping his freedom intact. Niles always made his intentions clear that he was a single man not looking to marry, and any time had with him was for fun and entertainment. But that never stopped a woman he dated from trying. The twins were the catch of the century. Handsome, sexy, single men with plenty of charm and style, the heirs to a vast fortune. Neither had ever been married or had children. They were ripe for the picking. And even though they were identical in just about every aspect, they couldn't be more different in their personalities and style of dress. Niles was a suit and tie type of guy, while Noah opted for more casual wear, but both men were well manicured and went to the same barber to receive the same trim. They had enjoyed looking alike since their younger years. They were still very much tied to one another, even though both were living their own lives and appeared to be on separate paths. Let me tell you one goddamn thing. Pause. It has got to be weird as fuck to grow... to grow up looking at a replica of yourself. That shit would piss me off. Because, like, what if your twin don't give it up like you do, like with style and dress like these two motherfuckers? I'd be like, I don't want people to be thinking you me. Hell, you out here bummy and shit. Like, you know, but dude ain't bummy. I'm sure he, you know, geared up or whatever. Just casual. He ain't no suit and tie type of dude. Okay, that's cool. But I'm saying, you know, like, for girls, like, what if your sister don't know how to style her shit and, you know, like, she nerdy and, you know, you not? Like, what do you do? I don't know. How do you distinguish yourself from that so that you get to have your own identity? That shit would trip me the fuck out. But you know what's funny to me? Real quick, and then I'm gonna get back to the book. There's two brothers on YouTube. I've been watching them for fucking years. They do, like, when people drop new music or when new movies come out or whatever, like, they do a review of it, right? So they be in the fucking videos arguing and calling each other ugly. Sir, the nigga look just like you. Like, I literally can't tell y'all apart. If y'all switch sides, I'm fucked. Because I don't know how y'all call each other ugly. They tell each other that color is not their color. That's more my color. Nigga, that means it's his color too, sir. Because y'all look just alike. If the color looks good on his skin, it looks good on your skin. Like, what the fuck? I don't understand. Yeah, it's crazy. So I don't understand how these two, I guess that would be trippy. Thank God I didn't have a twin. Because let me tell you one goddamn thing. No. All right. Call me later. Cheyenne said as she kissed Niles on the cheek. She smiled at Noah as she walked towards the door. Cheyenne didn't look back. She could feel their eyes burning through her back. She always wondered if they had ideas of bedding her at the same time. She had heard of their wild adventures as teens and young adults. It was well known in their close-knit circle that the two had engaged in multiple sexual trysts. Cheyenne smirked at the thought as she opened the door and let herself out. Child, wouldn't have been no smirking. I'd have been suggesting like a motherfucker. Listen, sirs. It ain't cheating if the nigga look just like you, is it? I don't know. Let's find out. Niles and Noah watched her, then looked at each other. They hadn't shared one woman between them in a long time, but if they were to indulge, Cheyenne would be perfect. They could tell she was attracted to them equally. I still need a cut and trim. Let's stop by Al's shop first, then go to the rooftop, Niles suggested. The rooftop was a favorite bar they frequented from time to time. It was a comfortable, luxurious lounge that catered to the elite. Patrons could stay indoors or relax outside on the rooftop and enjoy the view overlooking the St. Lawrence River. Noah looked forward to the outing. He needed a drink. He was still reeling from his conversation with George and needed to unwind. I went to see Pop, Niles said. Noah said, but Niles' name is right next to it. Niles turned his head quickly towards him. How did that go? I haven't been there in a few days. I needed time off, he said. Noah shook his head. It went how it usually goes. Terrible. He won't stop. Do you know he had the nerve to threaten me financially? Still on that shit with me and Jody. I'm not marrying that girl. I wouldn't give a damn what he did, he said. Niles understood. He too had his issues with their father. Well, at least you told him. Maybe he'll back off now. I pretend to listen when he tries to lecture me on my personal life. He thinks I'm a heartbreaker, so he won't set me up. Scared I'll embarrass him. Maybe you should run through a few... Maybe you should run through a few of his friends' daughters. Maybe then he'll stop that shit, Niles joked. Noah laughed. He pictured himself in such compromising situations. The thought amused him. It was an entertaining joke. The truth was, he couldn't be spread so thin. Those days were behind him. He was a different man. He wanted different things. He still believed in love. One between two people. He remembered the days of woman swapping and wild trysts with his twin. That's a lot. Okay, I ain't even gonna say it again. Noah. And it ain't that. The brothers were charismatic and popular among the single socialites of New York, especially Niles, who was a lot more outgoing and sociable than his younger twin. Niles was in and out of one relationship after another. He seemed to be running from love. Noah was running to love, and he believed it was coming. All he had to do was wait and be available when it arrived. Noah thought of how far he had come as a man, how much he had changed. He remembered the days of woman sharing with his twin, and although those were some of the best times, he was on a different path. Church lady with the eyeballs. No, ma'am. Both of y'all go to hell. I'm sorry. He was on a different path. Some of his best sexual experiences as a young man was on the heels of his brother. He was a lot shyer in his youth. Niles would pour on the charm and the women would be open to a shared experience, many requesting repeat performances. But Noah had since shed his fears. He wasn't the shy young man he once was. Y'all listen, it's a break in the chapter, and it's saying it's still 30 minutes left in this chapter. Bitch, I know you lying. Yeah, it's only, this book is only 12 fucking chapters, but it's like fucking 38 hours of reading. Shit, you got me fucked up. I love y'all, but not that goddamn much. Listen, Lord, have me sitting over here, throat drying shit at the back. No, God. Mm-mm. Hell, even Mr. Nigga give a bitch a break, you hear me? Oh. I'm going to hell. Lord, Lord, Lord. All right. Mm-mm. Okay, so here we go. What's up? Noah greeted their barber, Al, as the two walked into the barbershop. Hey, Niles said as he walked in behind his brother. Al had a customer in his chair, and the brothers would have to wait their turn. So, what's up for the evening? The barber asked, glancing over at them as he put the finishing touches on his customer. Al was a 32-year-old aspiring artist who used his family's wealth to open several barbershops in New York City. He had personally painted the mural on the side of his building, and he was scheduled to be featured in an upcoming art exhibit that Niles and Noah were backing him on. He, too, was estranged from his father, and so he and Noah had an understanding of what the other was going through. Who's first? He asked as he wiped his chair to prepare for one of the brothers. Noah got up and sat down as Niles checked through his text messages. He read a message from an ex-lover who was still hoping to rekindle their romance. Niles chuckled. The text read, "This is the last text I'm sending. I'm not gonna beg to see you. I miss you, and I know you miss me, but you're too stubborn to admit it and too much of a coward to do anything about it. I heard you seeing Cheyenne. Hope you catch a STD from her. She has dated just about everyone in New York. Don't be stupid. Are you purposely trying to get me back? And call me. We need to talk. Girl, yo thirsty ass. Like, I don't even understand. What the fuck?" She sound real fucking thirsty. Noah sat watching as Niles looked intensely at his phone. "Who is that?" he asked. "Alex. She wants to talk, but I'm not fucking with her. She has issues," Niles replied. Noah smirked and held still as Al turned his clippers on and trimmed his mustache and goatee. The shop was filled with customers waiting for shaves and haircuts. The men had great camaraderie. They laughed and spoke loudly, entertaining each other with talks of women, money, and prospects. Niles got in the chair after Noah was done, and after getting a lineup and a trim, left with Noah headed for the rooftop. "Hey, Niles," the waitress named Jasmine said in a sultry and flirty voice. Niles looked at her lips, then dropped his eyes to her ample backside as she walked away. He had plans for the young woman. She had been flirting for months, and he was attracted to her. Noah walked up and Niles handed him a glass of scotch. Noah hadn't had a drink in a while, but George was hard to digest without a stiff drink and a recap to make sure he didn't hold on to any overwhelming feelings. "Let that shit go, Noah. Papa always makes the same threats and the money continues to be deposited in your account. He told me he would cut me off if I didn't commit to working more hours. I actually dropped down to 2 days a week and he did nothing." Damn! "Ah, Pop just talking shit then. Fuck his bitch ass. He knows I work hard, but I have no intention of spending all my time in the firm," he said, hoping to get Noah in a better mood. "Oh, damn, I forgot to tell you. I decided to fly to Vegas. A last-minute thing. I need the lights, the entertainment. Indeed. Anyway, me and the fellas are going. We leave next week. You coming, right? It's your birthday, too. You celebrating or what? Unless you had other plans," Noah said. Niles thought hard. A trip sounded perfect. They had a birthday approaching, and he had a condo in Vegas that he hadn't been to in a while. It would be a wonderful getaway for him, but he didn't want to leave with their family planning a dinner party for them, and it was obvious that Noah had already decided against going. "What about the party at the house? Mom and Dad want us to stop by for dinner. We can't just leave and not show up," Niles said. "No, you can't leave and not show up. I'm going out of town. I can't deal with Pop right now. I'll call Mom later. She'll understand," Noah replied. Niles drank his scotch as he weighed whether or not to go. "Maybe. You know I just got back. I had no plans to travel again so soon. I'll think about it. I'll let you know. Just say you scared, bitch, nigga." "Just say you scared. Tell me, I'll let you know." No, you ain't got to let me know, motherfucker. You just let me know. Hell. Anyway. Niles and Noah drew a crowd of young, beautiful women. Soon their friends joined. The brothers laughed and talked as the waitresses kept the drinks coming. Niles had opened a tab and was treating his friends and the women near them. After an hour, appetizers were brought out and placed on the bar. The manager made sure to keep the Langston brothers happy on their brief outing. They were coming to the bar less and less, but their tab was the topic of conversation. It was always huge, and it was always paid for with an American Express black card. Niles noticed the waitress he had been flirting with. She turned to him and signaled, then walked back inside. He whispered in Noah's ear, then excused himself inside the bar. Noah and his friend Pete talked as Niles kept his eye on her. He made his way through the crowd, imagining some of the wildest thoughts. He looked at her ass, the way she walked at her backside, swaying. He had to have her. He was done playing. Jasmine glanced back briefly, then smiled and continued on. Once the two were in the back and out of sight, she aggressively kissed him and pulled him by his collar into a small storage room. Niles put his hand on her neck and pushed her into the wall in a gentle yet firm manner. She was instantly turned on. She smiled, then bit her lip. He was perfect in the way he handled her. Just what she hoped for. She'd lusted after him, and she hoped he was worth the time. He looked awesome in bed. She was eagerly hoping to see if she was right. Niles rubbed between her thighs and kissed on her neck. "Is this what you wanted?" "Yes," she said, her breaths increasing as his hands took over her body. She felt weak. He was intense. His touch made her tremble. His voice made her long for the next syllable. She tried to keep from moaning, but he felt good and she couldn't keep her composure. Not without bursting inside. "Shh," he whispered as he kissed her passionately. Niles was passionate. He liked sex with intensity. He gave his all and he usually left his lovers brokenhearted. It was an intensity that was short-lived. He feared getting his heart broken. He feared a woman controlling him emotionally, but Niles was contradicted. He wanted love. To him, it was fleeting. He believed he would know it when he saw it and felt it, that it just hadn't happened, and he envied anyone who was in love. He could only imagine how it felt, how it would make sex feel, adding to the closeness and making it profound. Thought that played in his mind as he expounded. No. What? How can he expound his latest lover against a wall? Okay, I think she meant as he pounded his latest lover against a wall in a back room. "If you don't keep quiet, I'll be forced to stop," he teased. Jasmine looked deeply in his eyes. He looked at her as if she was the only woman left on the planet. She hadn't felt so desired in a long time, so wanted, so beautiful. She wanted him. She had wanted him for the longest, but he burned hot as a flame, and she feared a heartbreak if she let him close. She was unaware that he had done his homework. He knew all about her. She was the daughter of a prominent lawyer working her way through grad school. She was newly single after finding out that her boyfriend had been sneaking around with the neighbor the minute she left their apartment. All information he gathered beforehand. Niles was more careful than he appeared. He didn't engage in trysts with random women. There had to be some knowledge of the person for whom he was interested in. He had been flirting with her for a year, unwilling to make a move until he watched and studied her, ensuring that he would be safe to proceed. He had a lot to lose. He was the target of women looking to improve their lifestyle. A tryst with the wrong lover could be a costly mistake for a man in his position. And as Jasmine dropped to her knees and placed him in her mouth, his head dropped back and he freely gave in to his passions. This was as random as it would get for him. And there's another break in the chapter. Again. I'm wetting my whistle because these fucking chapters are long. It's still 22 minutes left. I know you lying. All right. Lord, Lord, Lord. Okay. The Langston family sat quietly at their Francesco Francesco Milan, M-O-L-O-N. Is it Molon or Milan? Who gives a fuck? At the Francesco dining table. Some shit their rich niggas buy. Apparently, my little fucking Kmart, super Kmart table. Would never make the list. Y'all know Super Kmart used to be the shit back in the day because you could put every fucking thing on layaway, but whatever. Anyway, the sound of silverware clinking against fine china resonated throughout the dining room. At the head of the table sat an angry and frustrated George Langston. His son Noah was a no-show at the 30th birthday thrown for him and his twin. It was an expected disappointment. No one could say they weren't surprised. The family ate quietly. The tension was thick enough to cut. Nicole looked at her younger brother. He shook his head, then looked at their father. The siblings could see their father was not happy. Niles hoped to soothe his father. At least he was there for the festivities, a promise he made to himself despite his desires to be elsewhere. He had multiple invitations to travel and otherwise celebrate his birthday in grander style. Dinner at his parents' estate did little to excite him, but it would make his mother happy and his father content. His attendance was requested and necessary. He was aware of the fact that money would be given. He had received the second installment of his trust fund from his father and an expensive Grigio watch from his mother. His attention was anywhere but in the dining room. He read a text on his phone, then let out a light chuckle. Noah had just boarded a plane and was on his way to Las Vegas. He sent Niles a picture of a woman, then joked how he would like to fuck her into a coma. Nicole looked up at her brother. She thought he was texting his newest lady love, Cheyenne. There was always someone new. Niles had a commitment phobia. Things always looked promising. He dated some of the prettiest and most sophisticated socialites in New York. But as soon as things seemed to close in on him, he bailed. The tension eased as the family finished up dinner. It was time for dessert. Their housekeeper and cook, Gloria, made several cakes and pies to please the entire family. She made cakes and put Noah's name on one and Niles's name on the other. Noah's cake sat undisturbed. Niles looked at his father. George appeared to be in deep thought. Niles sent Noah a text. Pop not too happy. You leave me to deal with the fallout. Your ass should be here. You owe me. His twin brother was purposely absent. The situation between him and his father had become strained, and Noah was keeping his distance. Their father seemed to always be in a secret war with one, if not both, of his sons. They were doing their own thing, and he hated it. Both men were elusive and private bachelors, and both were uninterested in their father's wealth. Niles came out of respect, and he didn't want to appear as though he didn't appreciate his father's hard work, but he was much more than the son of George Langston. So was his twin. Niles had a law degree and had plans to open his own firm. George was disappointed when Niles pursued law instead of finance, and he was equally disappointed when Niles obtained the degree, then failed to use it, as if deliberately shunning the family business. And although he worked at Langston Financial, he had made it quite clear he wanted to be an attorney. Noah always stated his intentions. He did not blur the lines. He told his father as a young man entering college that he wanted to pursue his own dreams, and he refused to work at the firm. Eventually, he worked there part-time, but then stopped coming and started working from home. Even their sister Nicole had her battles with their father, but she was also a lifelong daddy's girl and often got into heated debates with her brothers over the treatment of their father. She believed they should follow in his footsteps and pursue the business he worked so hard to build. She saw the stress their lack of enthusiasm caused, and she was verbal about it, but she couldn't say she didn't get it. She too was being controlled by George, and yet she defended him to no end, because she's a mammy in the making. That's why. Her reasons, plain and clear, he was the money. Whatever he said went, and her husband, Austin, was on board for the advantages and lifestyle. A pussy-ass nigga married to you for the money? Girl, you should be ashamed of yourself. Unless his family got way more money. In that case, don't be ashamed. But this nigga's a bum, probably. Something they knew and allowed, so long as he kept Nicole happy. But even though they had their battles, the brothers loved their father. Their battles were surface. Deep down, he was everything. Noah pretended not to care, an act he kept up until one day he got a call. George got sick and was hospitalized. Noah panicked. He was the first one at the hospital and the main one demanding the best treatment and around-the-clock care for him. George laid in his bed, beaming, as he watched his most rebellious son stay by his side. Noah's presence ended up causing quite a stir. He verbally reprimanded the nurses for what he considered a lack of genuine concern. George knew his son loved him despite his sometimes difficult ways, and it was the reason why he never cut Noah off, even after he made threats to do so. Things weren't as dire as they seemed. There was still Nicole. Even if both Noah and Niles pursued other avenues, she was capable of running Langston Financial by herself. They saw no need to get too involved, but Nicole didn't want to be available. She was smart. She was good with numbers, but she really only wanted to be a wife, live a jet-set lifestyle, and travel the world. Even children weren't on her radar. So She wasn't thrilled about the idea of running Langston Financial. Niles worked part-time, and Noah hadn't worked there in years. He dropped in from time to time to visit Niles unless he was angry at their father. During the times when all was well, he would stop in and then help Niles on an account or two. It was always done in secret. He never wanted his father to know he had helped Niles. He feared his father using the opportunity to ask him to join. George was aware of what he was doing. He caught them discussing what to do with one of the larger investors. A conversation in private, or so they thought. George hoped he would reconsider. He was a natural at it, often turning the accounts around with his genius understanding of stocks. He was fanatical about watching every move the companies made, keeping up with trends, figuring out what was hot, dissecting every move. He was so accurate that insiders claimed he had inside knowledge, a rumor that George scoffed at. He was quick to note his son was a mastermind. Noah didn't want George to know everything he was doing, yet he always seemed to be informed. Noah figured it was Nicole updating him, and he had begun keeping her less informed. The tension eventually caused the siblings to become distant over the years, but the twins remained close, and it seemed everyone else was on the outside looking in. Even though the relationship was strained, Noah's presence was still expected, and his blatant disregard had his father at his wit's end. George was unapologetic for the heated debate that resulted in his son's latest hiatus. Before their last disagreement over his refusal to marry Jody Hawthorne, they had a falling out over Noah's decision not to start work at the firm, and Noah stayed away for 3 months, only calling Niles and his mother. It's another break in the chapter. I'm getting irritated because he ain't got to the part where he gonna ask him for the shit, and I'm annoyed. Fuck. Come on with it now. I feel like I done read 3 fucking chapters already. This is fucking crazy. All right. George cut a slice of Niles's personal chocolate cake, even though it wasn't his first choice. He wanted some of Noah's red velvet cake, but wanted to keep it intact. His way of making his son feel guilty whenever he did decide to come to the house. His wife, Ingrid, glanced up at him, hoping he would forgive their son. Is she white? Why the fuck is her name Ingrid? I've only known 2 black women named Ingrid, and they're both dead. Not that I think that they're the only black women that have ever... But these are supposed to be black men. Why is her name Ingrid? I don't know. I need to know, and I need to know about these women that he wants them to marry. Like, why are they so against it? Somebody make it make sense. All right, so Ingrid glanced up at him, hoping he would forgive their son. Her children were her pride and joy, but her commitment to her husband was first, above all else. Honey, you need anything else? Gloria made apple pie, his wife Ingrid said. No, I'm fine, thanks, he replied, his voice strong as it resonated throughout the room. His robust reply, a stark reminder that he was not happy at the moment. Gloria was their housekeeper of 20 years. She was like family. She had a 15-year-old daughter that lived in another country. The family was shocked when, after having the baby, she sent the child to live with their mother in Guatemala. They were never made aware of her pregnancy. She was short and heavy set with a large belly, and so her pregnancy was missed. Ingrid was hoping to help her raise the baby, but Gloria sent her away and never looked back. She started sending the girl money, but never sent for her to visit. It was a disappointment since the Langstons had no grandchildren. Ingrid was desperate to be a grandmother. She loved children, and she held out hope that she would be someday soon. I wonder if the baby belonged to old George Jefferson over here. Why the fuck she sending that baby away and ain't even let the damn baby come to visit or nothing? Why, the baby look black? Is that what the deal is? George, you been laying it low and spreading it wide? You got 2 in-house cooters, huh? Your wife's and the help's? Bastard. Listen, I done already made the man guilty and don't even have confirmation, child. George looked at Niles. He was the son who tried to indulge his father whenever possible. He had done as expected and made his father proud. George was optimistic. He believed that Niles would one day commit fully to running the firm. He hoped as much. Nicole was smart and able, but her life was filled with too much drama, and George didn't think she would keep the firm strong. George had no gripe with Niles. He seemed to be on a good path. He hadn't married prematurely, and he had no children out of wedlock. He seemed to be living with purpose, but a huge piece was missing still. Both George and Ingrid wanted to be grandparents, and none of the Langston heirs had children. Nicole was married, but she and her husband had decided against kids. He had children from his first marriage, and Nicole wasn't sold on the idea of motherhood. George had his reasons other than sharing his wife's love of children. He hoped to have heirs. He didn't want the Langston name to end with his offspring. He hoped there would be a long line of Langstons to come. He had faith. He believed that of his children, Niles was the one most likely to give him grandchildren. It was possible, but time was not waiting. George and Ingrid were getting older. They hoped to enjoy their grandkids while they still could. And with the uncertainty of Nicole and Noah becoming parents, Niles was the great hope. He was a man of great passion and warmth. They saw him settling down and eventually marrying, but the passions of his heart were under his strict control. He gave it out sparingly, choosing to engage on a physical rather than emotional level. He wasn't ready for anything deep. He only admired love. He wasn't seeking it out. Even though he was capable of immense depth and closeness, he was still running from it. And so they wondered about him. It was complicated. Marriage and family were in the cards for Niles. He wanted it, just not at the moment. And he was the only sibling that wanted children. Nicole was too self-involved to be a mother, and Noah wasn't capable. An injury when he was 16 rendered him infertile. But even if there had been no injury, Noah was not the father type. He believed he was doomed to be a bachelor, and that was okay with him. It was mostly his father's domineering and manipulative ways that turned him off from being a parent. And so he accepted his fate and moved on. The family continued to enjoy their desserts as the silence became deafening. Ingrid decided to break the ice by getting updates on her children's lives, something they hated her to do in their father's presence. Niles, why are you so quiet? Tell me how the classes are coming. You have just a few more months, right? She asked. Yeah, Ma, everything is going well. As a matter of fact, I can't stick around after dinner. I have an analysis essay due, he replied. The truth was he was considering going to Vegas himself. I knew it. I said, this nigga going to Vegas. He trying to hippity hop on a fucking private jet to get to Vegas before the festivities end. Right, because they a couple hours behind, couple tree. What is they, 3 hours behind Vegas? Yeah, they 3 hours behind Vegas. So yeah, he like, shit, 10 o'clock here, 7 o'clock there, party time. Right. All right, here we go. Where am I at? George smiled at Niles and finished his cake. He wiped his mouth with the napkin from his lap, then picked up a glass of red wine. Good job, Niles. I'm very proud, he said, nodding at him. George opened all doors for him. Niles sometimes found it easier to just get along and follow his father's plan. And although he didn't like to be told what to do, deep down he felt some responsibility for Langston Financial. Someone would have to run the company someday. Nicole wasn't interested, and Noah would rather die a slow and painful death. God damn. They act like it's that hard. Just hire people to do all the fucking work. And you make all the final decisions. You already know how to do the work. Well, what's so goddamn hard about it? But anyway, George had made it clear he was leaving it equally to all his children with a clause that they would have to sell their shares to one of their siblings before selling their share to an outsider. Noah did admire his father's success. His only gripe was that his father wanted control over him, and George underestimated his youngest son. Years of hard work, grueling hours, and a one-track mind on the bottom line cost him in the long run. George had assets that were worth millions of dollars, but extreme financial success did nothing to ease the trials of a broken family. He had a wife that adored him. Their life was stable, but his three adult children were another story. Noah, Niles, and Nicole were his pride and joy, and also his main source of stress. His daughter, Nicole, was on her third marriage at 34 years of age. This girl's a dummy. What the fuck is her donkey back ass out here doing? Why is she on her third marriage? Girl, what you rushing for? You the one with the power. Why you just marrying anybody? She doing that shit in defiance of her parents. Her beauty and wealth made her a highly sought-after socialite, but Nicole suffered from low self-esteem, which resulted in poor dating choices. She had been nipped, tucked, opened, and sewn back together more times than anyone cared to mention, all in an effort to make herself more appealing. No one understood. She was beautiful without all the surgery, but Nicole wanted boobs, she wanted an ass, and she got what she paid for. The new body helped boost her self-esteem. She was a more confident woman, but her choices in men remained questionable. She married her current husband, Austin, after 6 months of dating, a man she'd met while at a private party. Nicole hid the fact that they were dating for fear of her father's interference. The couple quietly eloped to the disappointment of her father, a move that did not sit well with her family. No one spoke highly of her new husband other than to say he was a decent fellow, words that caused George nothing but stress. He wondered about the man who had convinced his daughter to marry so quickly, a man he believed was after his daughter's fortune, his fortune. After much digging, George was able to get more information on Austin Douglas Hershey. He found out that Austin was living off the family name. He was always starting a project but never finishing it. Immediate family members were reluctant to say much more about the college dropout. He seemed intelligent, but it was obvious that Austin was a spoiled brat turned lazy adult with potential. George Langston was skeptical, and after it was revealed that Austin's father had essentially disowned him, George became alarmed. Austin had made grandiose claims, using his father's name to get people to invest in him. His plans fell apart, and people lost money. Important businessmen and women who were also friends of his father. Austin laid low after that, living off the money his father gave him to quietly go away. Nicole believed him when he said he was a successful business owner, and because he was the son of a prominent family, she assumed he was financially sound. When she discovered he was living off the family name and had no access to their businesses, she scrambled to clean up the scandal. George tried to soften the blow by hiring him to work at the firm. His daughter was in love, and so he tried to create an income and an image for his new son-in-law. Austin wasn't known for much of anything, and whispers from George's inner circle had him pegged as a lazy, worthless freeloader. George took him under his wing and taught him everything about finance. He caught on quickly and was soon entrusted with helping manage several medium-sized accounts. I bet you he's skimming off them bitches. George showed him how to manage money and invest. He paid for seminars and classes so Austin could get up to speed on how to handle the accounts, and soon he was turning profits. But money was the least of his new son-in-law's problems. He abused everything he could get his hands on, liquor, drugs, and sometimes women. George was unaware of some of his son-in-law's difficulties. He had faith in him. He believed a weak man could be made strong, that given enough time, one's character could be remade. George was thinking of himself with regard to that philosophy. It was possible, but Austin was missing one key ingredient, belief in oneself. Then there were the Langston twins, Niles and Noah, George's other two children, who were equally difficult to deal with. It was hard to distinguish between them. It seemed only their close family knew the differences. Everyone else would be hard-pressed to tell them apart, and the brothers were popular. They'd been featured in GQ and local magazines because of their wealth, good looks, and sophistication. As young men, they were often approached to model, but George wouldn't hear of it. He told them they would make their mark by hard work, not smiling in front of a camera. Niles, honey, where's Noah? He hasn't returned my calls, Ingrid said, her voice filled with worry. She didn't want to ask in front of George, but she couldn't contain herself any longer. She quietly blamed him. He pushed their youngest and most rebellious kid too hard, and now he was MIA. He went with his friends to Las Vegas, Niles replied, looking at his sister and preparing for the blow-up he was sure would be coming. What? Las Vegas? For what? When he knew we were throwing a party for the two of you, Mr. Langston huffed. Honey, please, it's his birthday. Let him celebrate it as he sees fit. We can see him later, Ingrid assured, attempting to pacify her hard-to-please husband. George looked at Niles. He was angry that Niles hadn't informed him beforehand. He didn't like surprises, and he would be leaving Noah a voice message as soon as he was able. Pause. Niles, nigga, you ain't shit. You just said that you was thinking of going to Vegas yourself, and now you're telling them where to look for you with your dumb ass. This nigga dumb. Oh my God. Oh my God, why would he tell that? Oh, he is such a fucking hater, yo. Do y'all understand that you got siblings that'll do that to you? You have other family. That's why I don't tell people shit. I'm not telling you a motherfucking nothing. Listen, if you ain't in the circle, motherfucker, no, I'm not telling you that shit. Anything I say, I don't care who fucking know. But you ain't gonna be all up on the inside where it counts. Shit, it take a long time to get you to talk about some shit like that. So this nigga, for him to be his twin brother and do that to him, y'all, how raggedy of a nigga do you have to be? Just listen, you ain't even gotta be, just don't be a raggedy human being, right? Because that's raggedy as fuck, yo. That's his twin brother. And he know his funky ass wanna be there too. Oh, this nigga like a hangnail, man. Just irritating. Oh. All right. Are you joining him? Nicole asked. This bitch. I don't know yet. Maybe, Niles replied. He pictured himself there. The condominium he had was lavish. It was one of his favorite homes. He had several that he considered investments. He would find the properties for less than their value and then renovate them, increasing the value. He kept some and sold the others. And the timing was perfect. He had work done on the condo in Vegas and wanted to see the finished work. He had given Noah access to it, handing him a set of keys just before he left, but Noah wanted to stay at one of the casinos. George stood up, his wine still in his hand. Ingrid smiled at her husband in an effort to ease his stress. Gloria walked in and grabbed Noah's cake. I'll wrap this one up, she said as she reached for it. No, leave it, George blurted. Ingrid looked at Niles. He looked intensely at his mother. He hoped her feelings weren't hurt. Niles could deal with his father's disappointment, but not his mother's. Hold on. Shit. I'm sorry, y'all. I had to look around, honey. Oh, Lord. Y'all know it be spiders and shit. The fuck? Just deal with it, goddammit. All right. So why do he want her to leave the fucking cake? George turned from the table and started to walk away. He turned back, the audacity of Noah still heavy on his mind. He's wrong. He's wrong and he's disrespectful and I will not tolerate it. And there's a break in the chapter. So I guess now this is the one time that he gonna cut him off. Thank goodness that Noah got a little change put away in his little piggy bank, honey. It's another break in the chapter, shit. It's still 4 minutes left, but I don't even give a fuck. I don't know. We might not make it through this fucking shit. Because these niggas ain't gave us nothing to go on. You keep telling me the same thing. Noah's rebellious. Niles is too. And goddamn, Nicole is a dingbat. All right, we got it. You got three useless, spoiled ass fucking brats. Because you fucked up, sir. And your wife's a mammy. That's it. We get it. Bella, why aren't you answering your phone? I called like a million times, Danny said as she stood in Bella's doorway. What? You called me? Bella asked. Yes, look at your phone, she replied. We're gonna miss our flight, she said. Well, hello to you too, Danny. I was getting ready, she said, closing her door and walking back to her bedroom. Danny followed her back. How many bags do you have? She asked, reaching down to grab the obvious one on the floor. Two small bags. I guess I have everything, Bella stated, looking around her room. I'm ready. Bella was glowing. She hadn't been on a trip in years, and she'd never been to Vegas. This was a special moment for her. Danny traveled all the time. She took trips with Ralph, her husband of 6 years. years, their lifestyle was a comfortable middle-class lifestyle that afforded such opportunities. But Bella's finances were not so plentiful. She had just opened a woman's clothing boutique near downtown Manhattan and was struggling to get it profitable. She spent her savings on merchandise and equipment needed to open it and was low on cash, but Bella was resourceful. She knew how to make money, so she didn't worry. But at the moment, she didn't have much to spare. If it wasn't for Danny's husband passing on the trip, she wouldn't be going. Bella counted herself lucky. She was the apple of her late grandfather's eye, and he left her a sizable inheritance when she was 23 years old. She eventually used some of it to open a casual wear clothing store for women. Danny helped her with the advertising and showed her how to gain a stronger following through social media, but she was still stressed. The first year was rough, but things looked promising. She wasn't financially secure yet. The boutique was gaining in popularity, and Bella was set to begin reaping some of the benefits. "Let's go," she said as she grabbed her other bag. She was looking forward to this trip. She grabbed her bag and the women left, headed for the airport. Their plane to Las Vegas was leaving in an hour. "Ralph didn't change his mind?" Bella asked. Danny gave her a look. "No, still being an ass. I'm just glad you could come on such short notice. I can't believe he is this angry with me. So angry that he would forego the trip we planned. He thought he would break me. I hate his stubbornness. I was going anyway. He knows me. I don't know what he expected to come from his backing out of a trip I planned months ago. Oh, well, he can sit and sulk while I have a blast in Vegas," Danny said. Bella looked over at her. Danny was in a good mood for a woman whose husband was playing hardball. She seemed jovial. Bella wondered how Danny could be so happy with her husband at home, missing out on a romantic trip, but she knew better. Danny definitely wanted him there. They did everything together. Bella didn't understand their relationship. They argued a lot and seemed to enjoy the makeups afterward, and both wanted to control the other. One second. "Well, I personally needed this trip. I'm glad I was able to even go. My sales for the month were not that great. And Brian, he wants to talk. He keeps popping up. I definitely need to get away," Bella reflected. "Sorry, Belle. He didn't deserve you. I mean, what changed? Now he wants to call. Now he's on his knees begging to come back after he's caught cheating," Danny said, glancing over at her friend. "Yeah, he asked me to marry him," she reluctantly said. "No, and you said no, right?" Danny asked. Bella didn't want to change the mood of the trip. Talking about Brian would surely switch the gears. "No, I'm not marrying him. Let's not talk about Ralph or Brian. This is officially a girls' trip, one we both need. We're going to have fun, see things, eat fabulously, and then return to our lives. We'll have 5 days of bliss. No negative thoughts, no speaking on anything unless it's positive, okay?" Bella stated. "Yes, okay. No Ralph and no Brian, just me and you on a 5-day fuck the men in our lives excursion," Danny laughed. "I love you, girl. Thanks for being the best friend a girl could ask for," Bella said as she touched Danny's hand. "You're welcome. Love you too, girl. We're going to have fun. I can feel it. Watch, this trip is special." And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, I feel like I've been reading all fucking day. I feel like I've been on my knees all goddamn day. What the hell? All right. So what are we thinking? We keeping this shit or no? 1 hour and 36 minutes, and this nigga still ain't asked for the goddamn favor yet. Annoyed. Tell me what's up. I'm waiting on y'all. And while I do that, I'm going to scroll through and see who said my name. Say my name. Let me see, child. Buck, who likes to fuck? Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you, child. You well rested. You're looking all bright and bushy-tailed. Listen. Let me find out, child. Let me find out. You've been rejuvenated on purpose. And with purpose, child. Listen. Lord have mercy. Hey, Nicole. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome. I'm still scrolling. Irk and Jerk. Hey, girl. Happy Friday to you. Welcome. Welcome. Hello, my name is my name. Welcome. New sub. Just wanted to say hello. Well, hello. Y'all welcome. My name is my name to the Speakeasy. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Girl, we still trying to find out. Pop gonna cut Noah off. He wants that money. No, Noah don't need his money, right? Pops want him to work at the firm. No, Pop want him to fucking marry that woman and then come work at the firm. Oh my God. Oh, you like it, church lady? All right. Okay, so Irkin Jerk been going to catch up child for 30 fucking minutes. Child, listen. I'm scrolling down. Okay, Lisa Moore. Welcome. Lisa Moore is new here. Child, Lisa, I'm going to miss you next time if you don't say hey, auntie, or hey, Saki, child, because listen, I be scrolling. I don't want you acting crazy. Tell me, the bitch don't even speak. Yes, she do. She speak when spoken to. Hey, Karma, child, where you been, girl? I mean, we ain't seen you since, oh, Lord, I don't know, since the last time Tyrese was crying on video. Welcome back, darling. She said, I was down bad, y'all, but I'm back and feeling so much better. I was catching up, and y'all done got wild in the speakers. Child, I'm glad you back, queen, and glad you feeling better, child. Welcome back, darling. Thank you for being here. She said, wifey, I'm scared to be in the backyard. Is it safe back there? Hell no. Child, listen. Well, it might be a little bit safer now, child. Buck and Demetria done, child, they got some kind of love connection going, honey. Listen, child, listen. My name is officially Chuck Woolery, okay? Child, listen, I'm making little connections, child. Mel Thomas, I still ain't made it to the backyard. I just collect the church fans at the end of the night. See, that's why Melly Mel ain't got shit on her. Right. Nothing in. The rest of y'all? Oh, I think I want to make that. That is sounding real. I don't know why, y'all. That sounds really fucking good. I don't know. That just crossed my mind, child. I'm going to see if I can get that scratulating. Watch out there now. Let me see. I'm still going. I think I got everybody. I'm going to see. Let me see. Okay, see, y'all just been talking. That's why I be scrolling, because I just be looking for my name, child. Y'all some talking asses. I love it. That's right. Talk. Give me lots of shit to read when the video ends. Hey, Kia, welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Yes, indeed. My little sister in the building, child, at 7-Eleven. What? What the fuck is really going on, child? She off up in here. Hey, girl. Hey. Oh, she 30 minutes behind. Okay. Now she gonna be pissed off when she catch up or whatever, child. All right. Wait. You said it was safe, wifey. I'm gonna get yelled at. But no, you ain't gonna get yelled at, child, unless you be back there twerking and lying about it like church lady. Because she be lying. All right. Let me get my next timestamp, child. Let me see. Don't lie about it like church lady, child, because she be lying. Tell me she was bending over, picking up stuff. And then when she had the blunt between her lips, she talking about it was a sausage. Girl, no matter what I say, it's going to come out wrong. So just listen. Just know I know the difference, okay? I don't care. I can't even clean that up, child. No matter how I try to say that, it's going to come. Lord, no matter how I say that, it's coming out bad. Whether I say I done had a whole lot of blunts between my lips or a whole lot of sausage between and I know the difference between the two, it was going to sound bad. That's why I didn't say it. See? Because, nah, what we not fit to do is that. Stay out my goddamn business. Y'all listen. All right. So now, y'all hush on up. Y'all just got about 10 seconds left before it count on down to the ground, honey. Lord. Oh, Lord. Okay, here we go. Chapter 3, The Switch. Oh, now we get into it. Watch out there now. Hey, watch out there now. Okay. Bella smiled as the plane touched down. "Let the fun times begin," she spouted. She didn't spout it. She shouted it. "Who's switching, y'all? It's got to be, I bet you Noah gonna say his name is Niles." How's that gonna work? Oh, shit. Okay. All right. I'm gonna be quiet. Y'all, I think we're gonna end up liking this. The people around her laughed. She and Danny had been quite animated on the flight and had garnered the attention of some of the other passengers on the plane. One gentleman in particular had his eye on Bella for most of the flight. "Can I help you with that?" the voice behind her said. "Oh, no, I got it," she said as she grabbed the bag, too distracted to acknowledge him. He walked past her, then glanced back at the attractive woman before exiting the plane. Danny sat checking her emails now that she had a signal. Bella watched as she sighed, then put her phone in her purse. "He'll call." "It's okay. I'm good. But what about you?" "Don't think I didn't notice that guy all in your ear. He was handsome, too. He was standing close enough to kiss you. We're not even in Sin City yet, and you already have admirers," she joked. "Who, me?" Bella replied with a chuckle as she grabbed her carry-on from the overhead compartment. The women walked off the plane and made their way to the luggage area to get the rest of their bags. "Where to?" the driver asked. "To the Bellagio, please," Danny said. Bella looked around. She wasn't well-traveled. She had been to 4 cities, and she had yet to travel outside the country. Growing up poor had major disadvantages. Even still, she didn't feel she had really missed out on anything. Her parents gave her love and support in abundance. Their loving presence and sound values had helped Bella develop into a strong and independent woman, raised to believe in herself and to know her value, money or not. "Oh, wow, this place is beautiful," Bella gushed as she took pictures. "When we get to our suite, we can eat first. Then I can show you the itinerary," she said. Bella turned her head swiftly. "What? Itinerary? Please tell me you did not schedule our days like we're at work," she said. Danny laughed. She knew it was a bit much to have a laid out hour-to-hour plan, but it was the way she liked to do things. "Yes, that way we make the most of our time here. I'll show you what I have selected. Anything you don't want to do, we'll fill in with another activity. I left plenty of hours open. I figure we'll gamble and hang out in the casinos at those times." Bella and Danny entered suite number 5201. "Ooh, lucky magical number 8. I like it, child. I like it." They immediately looked around. The accommodations were plush. The 2-bedroom suite Danny upgraded to at the last minute was more than comfortable. Bella went to the smaller room and placed her bags on the bed. She unpacked as Danny sat on her bed and went over the day's plan. They would eat first, then walk the streets taking pictures and sightseeing, then gamble that evening and end their day with a dinner. The next morning, they would pamper themselves with a deluxe spa package that included a steam sauna, massages, facials, and manicures. The night would end again with dinner. They had 5 days. Bella looked forward to it all. And there's a break in the chapter. Oh, child, I thought she was going to be trying to, trying to do like some, "Oh, we're going to go to this and see this site and see that." So listen, bitch. No, we finna do, since we on your husband's dime, we finna get drunk and gamble some money. That's what we going to do. Because all of the rest of this shit is I mean, but she might want to do it because she ain't never been there before. But that shit would be old to me. Hey, girl, listen, you better hope like hell I don't leave your ass and go find me something to sit on. That's what. I'm assuming she's single. The other lady married. Fuck you going to Sin City for? Hey, it's about you going to shop. Girl, fuck you. You can shop at home. Go get you some dick. That's what you do. Security had already been to Noah's suite twice, and they hadn't been in town a full 24 hours. They were loud. Calls from guests poured in. It was 3 in the morning, and they showed no signs of slowing down. Adding to the festivities were 3 women who had joined them for drinks and food. Noah took his drink and retired to his room. He wasn't a party animal. This was becoming more than he wanted to deal with. "Hey, why you in here alone? You okay?" Stephen asked. because I'm tired. It's cool. Just make sure you're the last to leave. I want everybody gone in an hour. No stragglers, Noah said. He was exhausted from the flight. He wasn't trying to be a party pooper, but he wanted to rest. Steve nodded and left out his drink firmly in his hand. Noah could hear his friends and their guests laughing and enjoying themselves. He wondered what his twin was doing. Niles could always get him in a better mood. He missed his other half. Their birthday would be over. He never had a birthday without Niles. If he didn't show, this would be a first. Noah sat on his bed and disconnected his phone from the charger. He saw he'd missed a few calls and messages. He scrolled through his calls looking for Niles' number. He was still hoping his brother would call and say he was on his way. He sighed when he saw no calls from him. He opened his social media accounts to see what he had missed. He had created accounts using various versions of his name to keep his family from finding it. Only his twin knew his accounts. Noah saw he had messages. It was an unread message from Niles sent a half hour prior. It reads, "Pop was angry that you missed the dinner party. I tried to smooth things over. He'll be okay. You know how he is." Noah shook his head and checked his other messages, then replied to Niles. He hoped his brother was still up. It was late. He texted, "No way was I spending my birthday with him. You should have come here. There's still time. We'll be here for at least another week, maybe longer. Why don't you come?" Noah waited on a response. He hoped that Niles would just drop everything and fly there. They were repairing a broken bond. Noah blamed Nicole and Niles for their father knowing his personal business, and Niles blamed Noah for the rift in their family structure. He wished Noah would just indulge their father and make everyone's life easier. He didn't understand the difficulty in it. "You go marry the bitch then, bitch nigga. The fuck?" A message came through from Niles. It read, "Need to sit this one out. Already have travel plans for next week. Going to Capri with a lady friend. I got you something, though. We'll see you when you touch down." Noah smiled. He messaged him back. "What, a Lambo this time, or perhaps a Tesla?" Niles responded back quickly. Noah figured his brother wasn't asleep. Even with the time difference between Las Vegas and New York, Niles would still be up. He was a night owl. Noah wasn't. The twins couldn't be more opposite. Their manner of dress, the attitude about life and family, their goals, all polar opposites. But their differences complemented the relationship. What one couldn't figure out, the other would. They worked together throughout their young lives and even into adulthood, figuring each other's problems out, being there for every letdown, every failure, whether they were at odds or not. Niles messaged him again. It read, "Damn, I guess that's obvious. Okay, then, what else do you want? Because I only give cars. How about a watch?" Niles loved cars. He had already purchased 5 cars for his twin brother. Noah wished he would buy Chevys or Buicks. He wanted to normalize his life. Expensive cars brought unwanted attention. Indeed. Noah shook his head and messaged, "I'll tell you what I want. Saw a beauty on the plane today. She was gorgeous, breathtaking, and her eyes. I tried to say something to her, but she ignored me. Had to walk away with my tail between my legs. She's staying at the Bellagio. Our limo was behind her taxi. Saw her go there. Come here and charm her. I won't be free. Gemma here. She beat me here, and it's my birthday. Unfucking believable. You know how she can be. She will not move on, no matter what I say. But this woman is beautiful. I gotta have her. Come on, at least until I get free. Like we used to do, remember? That's how I got my first 2 girlfriends." Now we know. Now we know. I'm annoyed. I don't know if I want to keep going now. Okay. This is going to be fucking ridiculous. Because he's going to end up falling for the girl, I bet. And this, come on, man. Okay. I thought it was going to be something else, like killing somebody or something. Fuck. I mean, I heard him talk about a love story or whatever, but I thought somebody was going to get killed. And that's how he wanted his brother to, I don't know. But I didn't think it was going to be this shit. You worried about Gemma. Fuck that hoe. You told that bitch it's over. Send her home. You scared to break bitches' hearts? The fuck? Anyway, Noah sat back on his pillows. He wondered if Niles would entertain him. His brother was a ladies' man. They were both handsome men, toned and fit with all the trappings, but Niles was the playboy. He was successful with women. Noah had to soothe many broken hearts behind his brother's hasty exit from their lives. He admired his brother's sexual prowess. The women always seemed to be fanatical about him, something Noah didn't experience. His dating experience was vastly different from his twins. Noah had trouble with emotion. He protected his heart fiercely, and he was extremely guarded by nature. He didn't mean to be, but he was never anything else. He was a man of limited emotions. He had looks, an athletic and lean build. Women were interested, and he was rich, and that made the women want him even more. But Noah always came up short in the area of chemistry and deep felt emotion. Several of his exes told him they couldn't feel him. He asked Niles what they meant. Niles wasn't sure, since he looked at Noah as an extension of himself and had never had that complaint. Soon a message came through. Noah opened it. It read, "Where you staying? On my way. Who is she? Why you going through all this for some random woman?" Noah replied, "You wouldn't say that if you saw her. She's no random. You haven't seen anything like her. Not even close. And she has a beautiful personality. I watched her like a hawk on the plane ride here. She's sweet, special, perfect in every way. Get your ass here. I would do it for you." Niles text back, "Okay, but she better be everything you say. You owe me big time." Noah replied, "I'm staying at the Mirage. When you arrive, get a 2-bedroom suite at the Bellagio. Don't go to the condo. See you soon." Noah laid back on his bed. He was nervous about getting Niles involved. He didn't want his brother to end up with her, but he was stuck. Gemma was on her way to the Mirage Hotel with her girlfriends, Khadijah and them. Sorry. And she was clingy. Noah knew once he entertained her, it would be hard to cut loose from her. She talked her friends into traveling with her to celebrate his birthday without his approval. But that was Gemma. She never asked for permission. She was crazy about Noah, but the feeling wasn't mutual. He could hear jazz music playing. It was a lot quieter. Soon, Gemma entered with her friends and sat on the bed with Noah. She kissed him and then turned her attention back to her friends. "See, this the part I ain't gonna like, the fact that he indulged in this dumb bitch and this bullshit. Tell her to take her fucking hooved feet home, fucking bitch." "Go away, damn." Anyway, she had brought along 2 co-workers she'd known for years. "Where's the drinks? I need something," her friend Stacy said. "Oh, there is definitely liquor here. I'll get the drinks," Gemma said, leaving her friends in the room with Noah. "Happy birthday, Noah," Allison said. Noah knew both Stacy and Allison well. It was through Allison's urging that he met Gemma, and he regretted getting seriously involved with her. She was pushy and aggressive. She was a lawyer and constantly battled him on every subject. Noah always felt like he was in court with her. Their whole relationship was one big argument after the next, and he had tired of it. But Gemma was not ready to let go. Her last-minute trip to Vegas happened after she found out through Allison's husband that he was celebrating his birthday there. "Well, why don't you stop talking too much, bitch boy?" And she was holding on for dear life. She wanted to be married, and he was the one she wanted. Gemma had no need for his money or anything superficial. Her love for him was real, genuine. He was the love of her life. It was easy to love him, but he was less enthused. He never considered it, and he wondered why she was so desperate to get hitched when they argued constantly. "Sir, she's an attorney. She don't see it as y'all arguing. She think that shit is normal. That's why I could never, ever, ever be with an attorney, because the way I would be fucking ridding your feet of their toes every time we got into a fucking argument. No, God. Mm-mm. No, I'm not doing that. No. No, 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 no. But you should just tell her anything. Tell her you are becoming celibate. Tell her you like men. Tell her you need her to be a furry 24/7. If you tell her you need to be a furry 24/7 in order for you to gain an erection, yeah, she'll leave you the fuck alone, because she gonna think you weird as fuck. But this is some bullshit. You letting this girl lead you. You're a pussy, dude. Anyway, Noah crossed his legs and leaned back on the pillows. He was comfortable. Even though Gemma was the last person he wanted to see at his birthday celebration, he was prepared to deal with the intrusion, partly because of his instant fascination for a woman he didn't even know. And how you gonna maintain said connection that your brother creates with this bitch, huh? If he the smooth jazz of the two of y'all, and you more like a fucking two-year-old on a plastic piano, how the fuck you gonna keep up the facade, sir? Bitches be knowing. That's kind of like a permanent change. Y'all personalities are night and day. Shit, he's smooth jazz and you fucking sandpaper. Anyway, a woman he saw on the plane, he could think of nothing but Bella since seeing her, and he had a plan that he hoped would work. Hey, knock it off. Sorry. And he had a plan that he hoped would work, his brother keeping her busy and happy until he could step in. It was risky, but he believed it was worth it. If her visit there was brief and she left, he could possibly never see her again. He would rather Niles keep her company. Hey, everybody's going back to their own suites. Dave taking some woman he met to his suite. Dude acts like he never gets out. He is out of control, Stephen said as he stuck his head in Noah's door. What? Are you serious? Noah remarked. He's a wild man, Stephen laughed. The truth was, they were all out of their element. They were a group of hardworking men whose lives weren't so dramatic. Stephen was a divorced father of three. Jason was newly married and had a one-year-old. Pete was married but had no children, and Dave was newly single. It's another fucking break in the chapter. I'm annoyed because you ain't giving me shit, ma'am. Another fucking thing. This Gemma bitch. That is real. Like, her mama name ain't tell her stop being so goddamn thirsty? Probably not. That's probably how her mammy got with her ignorant ass daddy. He pussy whipped too. Oh, overbearing ass chick. You know, it's some women that's like that. Like that damn bitch, Ashley Silver, DJ Quicksilver's wife. She runs his little half a person ass. He a little half pint ass nigga. Little half a motherfucker, and he always taking her side. She could be wrong as motherfucking peep toe pumps on a knock-kneed elephant. He's still gonna take her side. He's still gonna take her side. He don't care. I hate it because she feels like every man around her is supposed to respond to her bitch ass like that half a motherfucker that she married. And ma'am, it's some dudes out here that'll put you in your fucking place and they don't have to lay a hand on you, but back the fuck up. She played too goddamn much. Anyway, Noah stretched as he was awakened by knocks on his door. He managed to get Gemma to leave, telling her he was under the weather. Gemma wanted to gamble, and since she had her friends to keep her entertained, she left without incident. Noah walked to the door. He hoped it wasn't Gemma returning. He peeked out the peephole inside. He was regretting bringing all his friends. They could be party animals when their wives and significant others weren't around. Okay, okay, he said as he opened the door. Hell no. Are you sleeping? Let's go. Get your clothes on. We are out of here. We got shit to do. You not sleeping this trip away. We'll shop at Caesar's. Maybe get something to eat, Dave said as he opened Noah's blinds. Pete excused himself to the bathroom while Stephen and Jason sat down. The men were ready to start their day. Are you serious? Come on. It's 9 a.m. Yeah, exactly. Let's go. Again, with another break. Oh, and another thing about Gemma. Is she staying for the whole fucking 5 days? Or is she just there for the weekend? Tell her you burning or something. Maybe she'll leave you alone then. Anything to get rid of her. Like, what makes bitches back up off of a dude? I don't know. Whatever it is. But, like, ugh. I don't understand. Like, it seemed like she just can't let go of something. Niles touched down and went directly to the Bellagio. He was able to secure a large two-bedroom suite for himself and Noah. He plopped down on his bed and called his brother. Hey, I'm here. Where are you? On my way there. The fellas want to shoot dice. We'll be there soon, Noah said as he walked slowly through the lobby of his hotel. Noah got off the phone and told his friends that Niles had just arrived. His friends were happy that Niles came. They believed his absence was affecting Noah, and Niles was the life of the party. They looked forward to him adding to the festivities. There would be more everything, more liquor, more activities, more sightseeing, and more women. The men got in a taxi and headed to the Bellagio. Steve sat up front with a driver as Noah, Dave, Jason, and Pete piled in the back. The men laughed. They hadn't been stuffed together inside a cab since their college years. Do y'all remember the taxis from the 70s that had it? I don't know if y'all taxis in y'all town did, but it was like a big ass bubble, right? And it had four doors with the little taxi thing, light thing on the top. But in the back was two sets of back seats that faced each other, yo. And there was a little window behind the seat whose back was to the driver's back. And you could slide that across. First, they had it where the driver could lock it with a little latch, like the old-timey latch that you slide across, only from his side. But then they just said, fuck it, and they made it sliding. But you could pass like a little money or something through there. But there was a panel where you literally like couldn't stick nothing through to like, I guess, shoot the driver or whatever. But what tripped me out was the fact that it was these fucking seats, long bench seats that faced each other so that four or six people, like if they were super fucking skinny, could sit in the back seat. So six girls could sit in the back seat, you know, not black girls, child. Because, you know, we got hips and ass, and that shit spread out when you sit the fuck down. And you don't want your homegirl on top of you like that, because shit, it be fucking hot. So anyway, so maybe four black women could fit in the back, unless they some tall stallions like Megan, you know. Then in which case, it's probably just going to be about three of them, two shorties and a stallion. So yeah, but I just wonder if y'all ever saw those kinds of taxi cabs. I don't know. Anyway, let me get back to the book. All right. Noah was rich and could have easily hired a limo to take them everywhere. And Pete didn't have a problem telling him he expected better accommodations since he was the one with the money to burn. Noah, I get that you're trying to prove a point to yourself and your father and all, but can we get a limo while we're here? This is ridiculous, Pete joked. We have a limo. That's him behind us. I thought it would be hilarious to see us pile in a taxi, Noah replied. What? The men all blurted one by one. You play entirely too much, Pete said, as the men all agreed. Pull over. We have a ride, Jason said to the driver. The men joked with one another as they got out and jumped into the waiting limo. Steve was part of the joke. He chuckled as he and Noah gave each other looks. It was like old times, pranks and games. The men joked all the way to their destination. Niles came down and met them in the lounge. He turned heads in his navy Zegma Merino wool slacks and powder blue short sleeve button down. His walk commanded attention from both old and young women alike. His mystique and good looks were captivating. He looked like the type of man a woman wouldn't mind waking up to in the morning. Hey, what's up? He said as he hugged and greeted everyone. Where do you shop? Do you ever dress down? Pete teased. No, he replied with a chuckle. Even though the men were Noah's college buddies, Niles had formed friendships with them as well. He was especially happy to see his twin. It was their birthday, and he planned on celebrating every day he was there. Y'all ready to grab something to eat? Then we can hit the tables, Niles suggested. The men agreed and went to one of the Bellagio's premier restaurants before enjoying a few games of poker. Dave and Pete wanted to shoot dice. They talked Noah into playing. Noah was there to have the best time of his life. Although he wasn't a gambler, it was his birthday and he was open to trying new things. I'm game, let's go, he said as they made their way to the dice tables. The men yelled in excitement as Noah rolled the dice. Gemma texted Noah constantly trying to find out where he was. See, I already don't like this bitch. It's his birthday, bitch. He's somewhere birthdaying. Go home, ho, and take your ugly ass homegirls with you. She and her friends set out on a mission to go casino to casino until they found them. Noah ignored her calls as he continued to be in control of the dice. Niles stood next to him, cheering him on and sipping on Cristal Brut. Noah was on a winning streak. He had several glasses of champagne and had loosened up. Cheers from the crowd sounded again as Noah hit his point, winning again. He rolled again, and his point was eight. He shook the dice and rolled six. He rolled again and hit nine. He rolled three more times, finally hitting the eight as the crowd cheered. Several other men were playing and had been winning off Noah's good luck streak. he had made them a great deal of money, and one of the men was curious as to who the twins were. They looked wealthy. They seemed unconcerned as to whether they won or not, and there was an air of confidence about them, one that spoke of money and privilege. "Hey, don't I know you? You're someone big," the man said. "See, bitch-ass niggas in the crowd can't never keep their mouth shut and just motherfucking sidle their way over to the person and say, 'Hey, you know, I'm a fan, nigga. Can I get a selfie? Much respect.'" Your weird ass. That's what I'm telling y'all. These men be weird. Why you gotta bust it all out? What if he was trying to be low-key, ho-ass nigga? Go have some fun with your ugly-ass homeboys. Talking about you're someone big. Noah tried ignoring him. Niles excused himself to the restroom as Noah shook the dice and blew on it. He gave a half smile, then rolled the dice. He continued playing as the man continued trying to guess where he saw Noah's face. "I can't place you, but I know I've seen you before. Did you beat your dick to his picture, sir?" Super thirsty ass. Noah looked at him, then threw the dice again. The man continued to press the issue. Pete and Steven looked at each other. Noah had a short fuse at times. Suddenly, the man stopped and stared. "Oh, shit. I know where I know you from. You were in that last Forbes issue. This dude is loaded," the guy announced as his friends looked on. Noah paused. Niles walked up and stood next to his brother. "Twins, too. Oh, man, twice the luck there. Keep hitting those numbers. You got Forbes money, so we gonna be here all night, I suppose. Hey, this dude cannot run out of money," the guy shouted. Noah and Niles glanced at each other. This was the reason Noah had told his father he hated publicity. The last thing he and Niles wanted was an announcement of who they were. They weren't public figures, just the sons of a wealthy investor. "No, you got it wrong. Wasn't me. I'm not in Forbes," he replied, irritated by the man's aggressive conversation. Niles stood silent. He was becoming irritated and hoped the conversation didn't get too disrespectful. He was overly protective of Noah. He had no bodyguards, and the last thing they needed was a brawl. Brawls meant lawsuits. But the belligerent man continued. It was obvious that he was intoxicated. "Man, that was you and your family. I'm a fan of anything that Forbes talks about. If it's good enough for them, it's good enough for me. Damn, how does it feel to have all that money?" the loudmouth guy continued. Noah sighed. Dave could tell he was getting agitated, but the man had an entourage of unfriendly-looking men with him, and they didn't like the type that, or look like the type that would take an insult. Niles, Dave, and Steven hoped Noah would refrain from harsh language. He was known to get belligerent himself, even go as far as to swing fist if he felt threatened. "Hey, I said it wasn't me. I can stop rolling and you can take over if you want," he replied. The man looked fiercely at him. The crowd got quiet. The man was hard to read. Niles braced himself for a fight. After a few seconds of strange silence, the man laughed. "Nah, I'm good. No disrespect. You won me a shitload of money. No harm. I'm impressed. No need to get all bent out of shape. You got the dice hot. Keep rolling." The game continued as the man backed down and turned his attention to a woman standing next to him. Niles walked to a waitress and asked her to bring another round of what they had been drinking. His attention was off of Noah and the game as he flirted with the pretty young woman. Noah blew on the dice. His point was 8. He needed to hit the 8 again. 7 would end his winning streak. He shook the dice, then glanced up. A woman in the crowd with a familiar face stopped him dead in his tracks. It was the beauty from the plane. It was Bella. Noah froze. He couldn't move. He looked around for Niles, then looked back at her. She stood peering from the crowd, trying to see what the commotion was. Noah smiled at her. Bella gave him a half-hearted smile in return. Noah could see something was off about her demeanor. She didn't seem to be the same jovial woman she was on the plane. She seemed present physically, but not in spirit. There was a sadness in her eyes that she was trying desperately to hide, but it didn't escape him. He had watched her most of their plane ride from New York until they touched down, the reason he was determined to meet her. Noah's long pause caused everyone to look over towards Bella. She became embarrassed at the attention and looked away. He wondered how long she'd been standing there, if she heard the things the man who stood next to him was saying, but it was apparent something had her upset. He continued to shake the dice. He knew Bella didn't recognize him. He didn't believe she saw him on the plane. He sat in first class and had only recently came out of the coach section to seek her out. He sat in coach the remainder of the plane ride watching Bella. "See, you ain't even got the pussy yet, and you already downgrading your fucking life. Goddamn ridiculous. You think I'm giving up my first class seat just to be able to ogle a bitch in coach? We gonna suspend disbelief as if I would. And go, oh, he's so sweet. No, he's stupid is what the fuck he is. Paid all that goddamn money to you should have been on a private jet. Then you never would have saw this bitch. Your pussy whipped ass. You ain't even got it yet. She was too distracted with her and Danny's conversation to notice, and so she didn't see him. She was unaware he was the gentleman who stood behind her and asked if she needed his assistance. She looked at him. His long gaze caused her to turn her head and look around. She wondered if he was looking at someone behind her, but only men and two elderly women stood near her. Hold on. He was looking at her. Okay, he's staring at me, she thought. Noah blew one last time. He rolled. Instead of looking at the dice, he watched Bella. She blushed. His attention on her was a bit overwhelming. Niles stood off to the side, flirting with the waitress, unaware that Bella was at the dice table. He glanced back, but was unable to see his brother due to the large crowd that had gathered. Craps, the man said. Noah stepped back from the table. He hadn't rolled a seven in over 8 minutes. Dave picked up the dice as Noah slowly made his way to Bella. She could see he was interested in her. She turned around and left the table, hoping that the crowd would cover her exit until she could get away. Niles saw Noah walking and abruptly ended his conversation and followed his brother towards the lobby. He saw him walking with purpose. He looked ahead of him. That must be her, he thought, as he tried to catch up to him. Niles looked back. He could see Noah's friends back at the table. He continued following his brother. Noah sped up, gaining on Bella as she headed for the door. Bella walked quickly to the exit. She was in no mood to talk. Danny was gone. She had simply taken her luggage and left, leaving her in Vegas alone. And to make matters worse, she had just $300 to her name, courtesy of auto pay. Something that crushed her, since it was something she had been meaning to undo. She wasn't sure what had happened with Danny. She left no note, sent no text. Bella was now waiting on her mother to get another $400 so she could catch a flight home. The only saving grace was Danny had prepaid for the room, and it was paid up through Monday, 4 days away. Bella walked outside of the Bellagio. She was confident her mother would get the money. Connie didn't have that kind of money laying around. Bella hated placing a burden on her parents. She hadn't needed them in years, and she loved that she was in position to help them. But the timing of everything couldn't have been worse, and Connie needed to get it from several sources with a verbal promise to pay him back. Being of limited means would make that promise difficult, but Bella wasn't worried. She would make good on any money anyone gave her mother. Bella looked down at her phone. It was Danny. She sat on a bench. She held the phone. Anger and disappointment kept her from answering. But it killed her not to know what caused her friend to leave. She'd been gone from the room only a few hours. It didn't make sense. Hello? She answered. Bella, Danny said with worry in her voice. She closed her eyes and sighed. If Danny didn't have a good reason for abandoning her on a trip that wasn't her idea in the first place, their friendship would be over. Yeah, Bella said, her voice filled with pain. Oh, Belle, I'm so sorry. Ralph showed up, threw a fit, and because you weren't in the room, he called me a liar, said I was having an affair. We fought. Security came. He took my phone and threw it, then forced me to go back home. That's why I couldn't call you. I just got home, and I just got myself a new phone. Please forgive me. Are you okay? Bella held the phone. It wasn't a good enough reason. She could have left a note or maybe told the clerk at the front desk to give her a message. It made no sense. Friends didn't do this to one another. Bella laid the phone on her lap. She could hear Danny calling her name over and over. The sound of someone approaching caused Bella to break out of her trance. Hi, sorry to disturb you. My name is Noah. I just wanted to say hi, he said. His smile was refreshing, but Bella was too emotionally distraught to appreciate a handsome man making an introduction. Hi, I'm Bella. Nice to meet you, she replied dryly. He looked around and Bella turned her head as if to end their conversation on that note, but he was going home at some point. What? Okay, he didn't have much time. She was beautiful, breathtaking. He would never see her again, and he wanted to, while he still could. He hadn't thought of anything else since the trip began. It started and ended in the plane. This was his chance. Can I sit? He said. Pause, y'all. Wait, what if the twist is? He originally asked his brother, Okay, to get with Bella in order to, you know, make the intro for them. Nice to meet you. Why am I doing sign language, doing the nice to meet you? To make the introductions, okay? Nice to meet you, right? So that's that. But what if the twist is that now he wants Niles to pretend to be him with Gemma so he can do-do-do-do-do with Bella, right? So he's going to pretend, Niles is going to pretend to be Noah, and then Noah can go off and be himself with old girl Bella. I think I would like that better than what he's proposing originally, which is that Niles do it. But I'm thinking that's the way you fucking do it, because fuck Gemma. She's overbearing. Her navel probably dirty anyway. Anyway, let me get back at it. Bella let out a loud sigh. She hoped he heard it. She wanted to be alone. This wasn't a good time for her. She was stressed, panicked, in a new city with $300, which was not enough to catch a last-minute flight home. Sure, she reluctantly said. Noah was nervous. Bella was striking, and even though he was handsome and had seen his share of beautiful women, there was an intensity about her. She looked like a beauty who burned hot as a flame when she loved a man. She had qualities of innocence mixed with an exotic sexual gaze that had him reeling. In all his travels, he had never wanted a woman from first glance. She had that special something, and he wanted to see what it was. Niles watched from afar. He saw why Noah called him in the middle of the night about her. She was exactly what he imagined. It was hard to keep the Langston brothers' attention, and when Noah made a fuss, Niles knew she would be stunning. "Damn," he said as he stared at her. "Hey, where's Noah?" Steve said as he approached. "Huh? Oh, he's talking to a woman he met," Niles said as he pointed. Soon, the other men approached. "Should we hit another casino?" Jason asked. "Yeah, why not? Let's wait for Noah, then maybe we can go to Excalibur," Niles replied as he turned his attention back to his brother and Bella. He hoped Noah still wanted his help. He found himself attracted to her, an instant attraction, just as it had been for Noah, a rare occurrence since they had a slight difference in the types of women they were attracted to. Noah couldn't relax. Bella had him more nervous than he'd ever been around a woman. He looked back at the front doors. He could see his brother and friends waiting for him, but they would have to wait. Oh, thank God he didn't pussy out. He had no time. He would rather see them back at home than mess up his one opportunity. "You okay? You look upset." "I'm fine," she quickly replied in an agitated voice. And as soon as the words left her lips, she regretted it. Bella wasn't the type to lash out. He had done nothing to her. She was taking out her anger on him. She softened a bit. She didn't want to hurt his feelings. Noah looked at his hands. He leaned forward. Something was wrong. And then it dawned on him. Her friend was nowhere to be found. "Where's your friend? The young lady that was on the plane with you?" Bella turned her head swiftly. "You saw us on the plane?" "Yeah, I asked if I could help you," he replied. Bella remembered the voice, and she also recalled that Danny had told her he was attractive. He was. This was a weird coincidence. "Yeah, I remember you," she said, pausing, then looking away. Noah waited. He didn't want to seem pushy. He wished Niles was sitting there instead. He feared messing up and turning her off, and he feared Gemma approaching and flying off the handle. Noah looked around at the crowds coming and going. He looked at Bella. She seemed determined to push him away. He watched her side profile. Her attention was somewhere else. Bella looked at him and smiled. He was gentle. He showed concern, had an unassuming quality that she admired. He was like her father, the father she adored, the man she could go to and talk about anything with. Bella wasn't sure why she trusted the moment. She didn't know him. She didn't need anything from him. And so she spoke. She was open, expressive, couldn't help it, talked when she was comfortable. She was the daughter of Lewis Bradley, a self-proclaimed seeker of truth, a believer in expression and freedom with words. "My friend left, didn't say anything to me, up and left me here. Her husband came and she just left. No note, no message, nothing. And my plane ticket is gone. She's never done anything like that before. I trusted her, but I guess she was cornered. Here go my question. Why the fuck is she back at home and you got the room for 5 days, drop the goddamn plane ticket in a FedEx overnight envelope and send it back to the bitch so she can come home? The fuck? It is not that hard." This bitch acting like she gotta make flan or something. I'm trying not to be mad, but I can't help it. Her voice trembling as she wiped a tear. She tried not to cry. This was a man who did not know her. She felt guilty airing her emotions on him. She didn't want him to feel sorry for her, and she wasn't looking for any handouts. Her parents would be calling soon. She was simply buying time, but it hurt deeply. Can you get back? I can get your ticket for you, he said. Bella looked at him surprised. Wow, you would do that for a stranger? No, I would do that for you. Bella looked away. His generosity and kind words soothed her broken heart. Noah couldn't see her face. He almost brought her to tears. But Bella pulled herself together. Her problems were not his. She was surprised he offered. Even though she was sure he was financially capable, his winning roles at the dice table hadn't gone unnoticed. No, my mother and father are going to wire money to me. I just need to find a Western Union. Bella refused to look at Noah. She wasn't ready for a stranger to see her weak, looking helpless and stupid. She wasn't ready to be judged for going on a trip and not having enough money to get home. I'm sorry. I'm not trying to put my problems on you. I have to go. It was nice talking to you, she said as she got up and walked back into the Bellagio. Niles stood out of view as Bella passed them in. Hello, beautiful, Pete said. Soon the other men spoke. Bella gave a quick glance and hello and kept walking. She didn't notice Noah had a twin and he was standing right behind the men. Noah walked in behind her. He watched her walk towards the elevator. He felt bad. He wanted to ensure she was all right. Abandoned by her friend with no money had to make her feel vulnerable. But she was not open to gifts. She reminded him of himself. He hated gifts. He hated feeling indebted to anyone. His father used money that way, and Noah despised the use of money for personal gain. He believed that people who wanted to give you something were looking to get something. He couldn't help but wonder if she felt that way. Niles and Noah walked a few feet away to talk to one another. What happened? Niles asked. She's upset. Her friend left her here. What? Niles said. Yeah, her name is Bella. She'll only be here a few more days at the most. Now that she's alone, I offered to give her the money for a flight out of here, but she wouldn't take it, he said. Niles was shocked that someone would leave their friend behind. Well, you still want me to keep her company? Niles asked, hoping the answer was yes. Bella looked intriguing. They were so close in physical characteristics that it was difficult to tell them apart. Same size, facial hair, and features. Same voice. Only differences were mannerisms and manner of dress, which they would mimic to pass as the other. But things were different. They were older. Bella was attractive enough to want, really want. Noah wasn't so sure it was a good idea. He was having reservations about letting Niles meet her. It was a difficult decision. Noah thought hard, his mind raced. Soon he worried about losing out on her completely. She would be there a day or two tops. He had no choice. He needed Niles. Gemma was still there. He couldn't risk it. Noah looked at Niles and shook his head yes. Fuck! Niles picked up on the hesitation. Wait. Are you sure? You don't seem on board with it. It's cool. I'll go to my condo. Stay a while. This is like a second home for me, so I'm good. No, I'm sure. Stay here at the Bellagio so you'll bump into her. She's upset right now, but yeah, if you can, talk to her. Get her to open up, he replied. Noah gave Niles a look, his gaze one of serious intent, a message he needed to make clear. Don't sleep with her, Niles, he warned. What? Of course not. I'll just befriend her. It's cool. Don't worry. I can handle this, Niles said. Niles wondered if he'd be able to get close to her with such a traumatic event occurring. Being left behind seemed stressful. He wasn't sure it was a good time. It doesn't matter because she's probably not open to meeting anyone. That's pretty traumatic, being left like that, he said. Noah agreed. She's probably in no mood to hang and Gemma on her way. I can't shake her. After this trip, I'm ending this once and for all. I can't do this with her, Noah said. Niles's mind raced. He secretly wanted to meet her. He tried to appear unfazed, but he was just as intrigued as Noah was. She's waiting on her mother to wire her money? Her friend actually took her plane ticket? Damn, Niles said. Yeah, it's fucked up. I feel bad for her. Like I said, she wouldn't let me give her money, Noah replied. Niles squinted his eyes in surprise. He admired her dignity despite being in a compromising position. She didn't take the money and offer to help? Niles asked curiously. Nope, not a dime. The brothers walked back over to the area the left. Wait a minute. I think where they left is what she meant to say, but she put the. the T-H-E, to the area they left their friends, but no one was there. Noah glanced over at the dice table. Dave and Pete had returned. They were in heavy conversation with the women from the night before. Soon he spotted Steve and Jason. He held his finger up, signaling to them to wait. Steven nodded. Noah and Niles went to the front desk. Here go my question, though. What about all the fucking money he was winning on the table when he ran out the door after this bitch? Y'all know how I am about shit like this. And you ain't gave me no goddamn closure on that money, ma'am. I need to know what's up. Like, you ain't make shit make sense to me. And why this bitch staying with a dude, Ralph? The nigga named Ralph. Why he abusive? He mad because his name Ralph? Change your name, nigga. Damn. You can still do that. Anyway, Noah and Niles went to the front desk. Niles flashed his American Express Black card and quickly paid for his own suite at the Bellagio. It was where he would be staying for the remainder of the trip. It's a break in the fucking chapter. I don't know, y'all. See, he doing this fucking shit. I thought they was gonna do the flippity-dippity like I said, but since they didn't, man, fuck it. I mean, I'm still read the shit, I guess, if y'all want me to. Otherwise, I'll switch to something else for tomorrow, because this is some bullshit. I done got annoyed, y'all. Y'all know the third chapter is where I usually be like, man, fuck this shit. Oh, Lord. All right. Hold on. Like, I'm trying to see what's going to happen. But fuck, man. It took all of this fucking double speaking shit. They got too many fucking problems. Their whole life is a problem. They make it seem like having money is a problem. But it ain't a problem, so I don't understand why it's a problem. Bella woke up and stared out at the city line. Vegas was beautiful. She wished she'd been able to enjoy it completely. Her father promised to wire her the money in 2 days. He asked if she had enough to eat with. Bella assured him she had enough. Wait a minute. This bitch nigga Ralph didn't come in there and see her homegirl's clothes strewn all over the other bedroom. So he's still thinking she cheating, even with somebody else shit in the room. And the homegirl took the ticket. Oh no. Fuck. This nigga just dumb. Anyway. They talked and Bella relaxed. He worries were over? I think she meant her worries were over. She got off the phone and watched TV, then jumped in the shower and prepared for the night. She climbed into bed with nothing on. The bed felt good. She was comfortable. She held the sheet against her naked body. She loved to sleep with nothing on. The bed was plush. The sheets cooled her skin. She needed to stay cool. The stress of the day had her hot and uncomfortable, but everything would be all right. She laid back and fell asleep, the best sleep she had gotten in days. She ain't got no fucking money to eat nothing because she needed the extra $400 from her people so that she could fucking get home. So how's she gonna fucking eat? Bella woke early the next morning. She sat up and looked out the window. She had to admit to herself that Vegas was beautiful. She wished she had enjoyed what the city had to offer. She glanced at the nightstand. A menu sitting next to the phone was enticing. She had to be careful not to buy expensive food items, something easy to do in Vegas. She had to preserve what she had, even though more money was on the way. Bella opened the menu and then picked up the phone. She saw they had a breakfast special. It was perfect. Hi, I'd like to order the breakfast special, ham and eggs, and an orange juice. Sure, Mrs. Langston. I'll send it right up and charge it to your room, the woman said. Wait, my name is Bradley, Bella Bradley, she said. The woman held the phone. Yes, I know, but the gentleman paying your bill didn't have a last name, and so he said to call you Mrs. Langston. Bella hung up the phone slowly. She was in a fog. She played the conversation back in her mind. Did she say, gentleman, paying my bill? Wait, what? What gentleman? She thought. As she got out of bed, she instantly thought of the man who sat with her. It had to be him. There was no one else, but I thought the room was already paid for. So did this author forget? Remember, the room's supposed to be paid for already. Said, luckily, Danny had paid for the room. Right. Anyway. She instantly thought of the man who sat with her. It had to be him. There was no one else. Bella walked naked into the dining area and noticed an envelope near the door. Her eyes lowered. She wondered what it was. Something had been slid under the door. She walked over to it and saw it was a sealed envelope with the words, "For you," written on the front. Bella could tell it was money. A lot of money. She opened the envelope. It was as she guessed. She gasped. The envelope was filled with $100 bills, enough to charter a plane if she wanted. "What? Oh, my," she said. She could see a small note in between the bills. She removed it slowly as she teared up from the generosity of the stranger. "It ain't the same dude. That's the problem." It was overwhelming. She didn't know what to say, and she didn't think she should keep it. Bella hoped the letter contained information on how to get to him. She would need to return the money to him. It was way more than she needed, and she felt strange accepting it. The note read, "I can't rest knowing you may get stranded here. Take this money and get what you need until your plane leaves. You owe me nothing. This is the money I've won since I've been here. I'm not a gambler, and I'd rather give the money to someone who really needs it. Don't try to give it back. I know you probably don't like accepting help. Neither do I. That's how I know. Please get your ticket. Keep anything left. If you refuse to enjoy it, that's okay, but please at least get your ticket. I'm in suite 909. If you want to talk, you can call my room. If you want to eat, meet me tonight at Prime. I have reservations for 8 o'clock. Bella grinned. His generosity was overwhelming. She couldn't help but think he wanted something from her. There was a lot of money in the envelope. She was afraid to count it. She guessed it to be around $10,000. "Wow, I'm speechless," she said to herself. She decided she would spend what she needed and give him back the rest. She had no desire to shop, no desire to purchase expensive tokens. She wanted peace of mind, to know she had a way home, and the handsome stranger from the plane just eased her worries. She was calm. Her fears now subsided. It was something she would have done if she were financially capable. Right. It's just what you do. Anyway, she smiled as she walked to the bathroom. She needed a warm shower. Then she needed to get her flight scheduled. But Bella wasn't going anywhere until she had dinner with her savior. This was what chivalrous, good-hearted men did. She wanted to know him. Men that looked like him didn't do such things. And now her apprehension had turned into curiosity. She was intrigued. All right, that's the end of that chapter and the fucking end of my patience. So, face, what are we thinking? What are we thinking? Sorry, I was fussing. About blowing stuff in my face. Hey, Naomi. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Okay, right. Niles want to fall in love too, so he gonna snatch her up, right? She talking about don't be mad now, auntie. Child, listen. I don't know, y'all. I just said, do we really want to know what's gonna happen, or can we already guess these two niggas about to be going to war for this bitch? Ooh, child, let me make sure the camera's working in the back. Watch out there now. People talk about getting on handstands and carrying on. Lord have mercy. All right, let me see. Where I'm at? I'm going. I'm scrolling. Wait, drunk bastard. What drunk bastard? Oh, talk about the bastard at the table. Okay, I got it. Child, I was confused. Right, send her funky ass home. She remind me of that fucking Gemma from The Shy. Oh, pushy ass. Oh, fight the power ass, bitch. Go sit down somewhere. Shit. Oh, pushy ass. I don't like pushy motherfuckers. Like, you doing too much, bitch. Like, get a clue. This nigga is not feeling you. That part, Buck. That part, nephew. All right. Did I miss anybody? I don't think so, child. Let me see. Let me see what my name is. That's what I told him. It's only 12 sakis. 12 sakis. God damn it. 12 chapters. Oh my God. Yeah, it's only 12 chapters, child. Lord, don't tell me. I need to know what you need to know, little sis. Tell me what you need to know, boo. I think this one of them turn to the last chapter and read it and be done. Wait, even Tamika, a newbie, says, shit, I'm 50-50 on this book, and I ain't even had nothing to drink. I feel you, Tamika. I feel you, boo. Child, listen. Girl, wait, did I speak to your ass earlier? Well, I was talking about I feel you, Tamika. Did I miss you, girl? I don't know. If I did, I'm sorry. And if I did, hey, girl, hey, but you should have said something, shit. I done told y'all bringing y'all long-haired asses in here and not saying shit. Then talking about something. You ain't even speak to me in the DMs and shit. Get your ass out of here. You should have said something in the middle. Wait a minute. Okay, so Buck said, now these chapters. It's a 3-in-1 on each chapter, right? Ain't no epilogue for this one, Buns. Mm-mm, ain't no epilogue. Let me see. No, it ain't no epilogue. It's just 12 chapters. And, yeah. So what y'all want to do? Y'all, let me know. Hold on. I'm sorry, I'm responding to my husband. Hold on. All right. I'm an asshole. Yup. Okay, here we go. Let me see. Oh, wait a minute. Hold on, y'all. I'm waiting on y'all to tell me what y'all want me to do. Oh, shit. Okay. But I don't know if that works. There we go. Okay, sorry. All right, I was actually trying to look at another book too after I answered him in case y'all decided y'all didn't want this one so I could give y'all the what you call it. All right, so let me scroll back up and see what the fuck y'all said. So Bun said the epilogue. She said she was preoccupied on the phone. Yeah, the third chapter, child. Okay, Tamika said, I agree with Buns. Read the last two chapters. Shit, the last two chapters is probably going to be long as shit, too. Just like these long ass ones. You know we nosy. Keep going. I'm going in the house to get my Aquarius together. You so stupid. Auntie just got that. Hey, how long you been? Shut up, Buck. Anyway. So Jan said, let's get the last two. We're too deep in to stop. That's what he said. Okay, right. Look at Jazz said. That's what he said. We too deep in to stop. Listen, I was watching that goddamn Diara from Detroit last night. She told old boy, just put the tip in. No, first he said, I'm going to just put the tip in. And so she's like, no, we can't do, because she's supposed to be being celibate. So then she finally said, okay, just put the tip in. So he put the tip in, right? So she was like, okay, wait a minute, just put the shaft in. He said, just the shaft? She said, yeah, just the shaft. So she said, oh my God, all right, just 3 strokes. He was like, okay. And so he hit her with the boom, boom, boom. And she was like, okay, 3 more strokes. Bitch, just fuck the man. That whole fucking episode tickled me, child. I like that little show. I do. But yeah, that's that was a little story about that. But yeah, shut up. And child, don't be saying nothing bad, girl. Don't be bad, Mel. I mean, Jan. So Mel said, I'm nosy as hell, so I'm going to say keep going. Bun said, but if you feel like reading, we'll listen. The only caveat is you can't cuss us out later. Right. Okay. Right. That's the only caveat. You're right. Okay. Oh, okay. It's up to me. It's too long. Yeah, I felt like it. Like, I need the chapters to be a little bit smaller. Like, where they putting these breaks could technically be chapters. You know what I'm saying? Mel talk about, hey, yo, right. Listen, it is what it is. All right, well, fuck it, because I need to know. I got a feeling these niggas about to go to war over some bullshit. But y'all give me 1 second. Hold on 1 second. Because y'all going to get about another good 20 minutes up out of me, and then that's it. All right, hold on. Shut up, Mel. Oh my God, I come back to the screen. <Mm-mm>. No, that's not what that was. No. Y'all silly. Mm-mm. Mm-mm. All right. Coffee is good. Y'all have no idea. All right. I got a little water. A little water too. Lord. All right. Here we go. Let me get this time stamp, child. Why is this thing not moving? I don't know what the deal is. All y'all can go to hell. For real. No, God. Nah, I ain't going to the shed. Oh. No, it's because y'all silly. Mm-mm. Y'all have no idea. Y'all have no idea why I'm laughing. Y'all silly. All right, knock it the fuck off. Knock it off, knock it off, knock it off. All right, let me get this time stamp, child. I just refreshed the page on y'all, and y'all didn't even realize it. All right, now we got it. Let it count on down to the ground. Oh, and I wanted to share with y'all rather quickly that I'm actually, girl, not even, child. I ain't even put it in my mouth yet. Not yet. I'm going to get your ass clean. You so silly. She talking about hot and ready. Oh, Lord. Why are y'all so fucking ignorant? Made me miss my damn timestamp. Fuck. All right, hold on. This is what happens. All right, there we go. All right, I got it. Hush. Shh. Don't say nothing. Everybody be quiet. Oh, I was saying, I'm thinking about putting the vape down. Like, I'm sick of it, you know? And I think I'll just wear the patch. But I'm thinking about it. All right, here we go. Chapter 4. An unexpected love. All right, here we go. Now, we don't know if she gonna have an unexpected love with Niles or Noah, but she gonna know them both as Noah, I bet. Shut up, punk. All right. Hi. Reservations were made for 8:00. My name is, Bella said before the hostess interrupted her. Right this way, Mrs. Langston, he said, as he turned and walked towards the back of the restaurant. The restaurant was breathtaking with a spectacular view of the amazing water fountains. Bella looked beautiful in her multicolored pink paisley dress and hot pink heels. She turned heads as she walked towards the inn near the fountains. She could see Noah in the distance. He was gorgeous. He was dressed in tailored slacks and a dark blue button-up shirt with cufflinks. He looked like money. He looked different. Not that he needed much help. He was a woman's dream. His almond-shaped eyes and thick eyebrows were tantalizing. His body was perfectly chiseled in all the right places. She wondered how she missed his sex appeal. She was upset, but she didn't think she was that upset. He was hard to miss. Bella was enamored. Hi, it's Noah, right? She said as he pulled out the chair for her. He cleared his throat. Yes, how are you this evening? Great, thanks for dinner, she said as she pulled her chair closer to the table. Bella looked around. She loved the decor. Their view was spectacular. He was nervous, but tried to contain himself. This place is beautiful. Yes, I love the atmosphere here, he replied as he put his napkin in his lap. Bella followed suit. She was not educated on the proper ways of fine dining. She watched him closely. He seemed to know a thing or two about it. They have the best steak, the best lamb, or if you like seafood, they have that too. What do you like? He asked, looking at her intensely. He was taken with her. Bella had charisma and charm. Her sex appeal was undeniable, and he found himself wanting to bed her. Her lips looked as though they felt wonderful. Her eyes were sensual. Her voice, sexy. He looked away briefly. It would be an insult to lust over her, and she had just arrived for their first dinner together. Boy, you can't sleep with her. This is your brother's woman, sir. I don't like this, y'all. I feel like this is a problem. Okay. Seafood is good. Oh, I didn't know you was back there. Hold on one second, y'all. All right, sorry about that. Seafood is good, Bella said, looking around again. She had something she wanted to say, but she didn't want to hurt his feelings. She didn't want to appear ungrateful. I got my plane ticket. You gave me much more than I needed. Your note said not to give it back, but I'm afraid I have to. I can't keep it. But I want to thank you for helping me. Because of you, I have no worries now. He paused as the waiter approached. What will it be, ma'am? The young man said. Oh, I'll have salmon with potatoes and a stuffed pepper, Bella said. She'd already looked at their menu before she got there. He sat his menu down. I'll have the filet mignon with green beans and potatoes, he replied. The waiter took their menus. This is for you. Again, I want you to. No, again, I want to thank you, she said, as she handed him the envelope. He smiled and then picked up his water. What? Take this. It's yours. I have no need for it. I have enough to eat with. I'm okay, she said. No, I can't. I found it. I'm gifting it to you. You owe me nothing. Don't think I'm using money to get close to you. I want to do that anyway, money or not, he said, with an intensity that could not be ignored. Bella looked at him. She blushed. She was attracted to him. It was hard not to be. He looked passionate. He looked like a man a woman would get hooked on, and the way he looked at her was flattering. Bella was aware of her beauty, but she never had a man make her feel so much more beautiful. She sat the envelope in front of her. Okay, all right, I give up, she replied. She liked him, everything about him. She would allow him to get to know her. She wanted to know him. His aura was pleasant. His words were like music. He said the right things. She wasn't easy to calm. She had just exited a bad relationship with someone who was terrible with his words, with his expression, with his love and lack thereof, but not Noah, the man she thought sat across from her. She was unaware it was his twin, unaware of the difference since she had nothing really to compare it to. She hadn't gotten to know Noah. She spent her time looking away from him during the time he sat next to her and she regretted it, but she would make it up to him. She liked him. He wouldn't be ignored this time. He was engaging, magnetic, charming. He listened intently to her, hanging on to her every word. They talked for hours about their lives, their work, and family. Niles wondered if she noticed a difference. He promised Noah he would take her on a few dates and then change it to phone conversations only until he was free to step in. Niles was careful about what he said. Noah had told him not to reveal too much personal information, but Bella was easy to talk to. Niles walked Bella to her suite. She opened her door. He hoped to be invited in, but Bella was reluctant. She didn't trust herself with him. He was too sexy to be alone with. She would want him, and they just met. Well, I'm going to turn in early, watch TV until I fall asleep, or maybe the TV will watch me. Yeah, me too. You free for breakfast in the morning? Yes, I would love that. Bella walked into her suite and said goodbye as she slowly shut the door. She stood there. She wanted to open the door and invite him in, but her willpower was strong. He would have to wait to be with her, even though he turned her on. She had been intimate on the first date before, a relationship that ended up lasting 5 years. She wasn't totally against passionate encounters if the mood was right, but she wanted to matter to him. She figured he'd had a lot of first night affairs, and she wondered if they ever lasted past the initial lust. The next few days were spent seeing every corner of Las Vegas. Niles eventually told Bella about his condo not far from the Strip. He promised to take her there, but Bella had never been to Vegas before, so he suggested they continue staying on the Strip so they could see everything. They attended a show each evening and always ended their date with dinner and a walk. Noah put his jacket across her shoulders to keep her warm at night, and during the day, they hung out at the mall and attended cinema shows. Bella was in awe of Vegas, and she was in awe of Noah. She took pictures and walked through all the hotels and casinos. She purchased souvenirs and gifts for her parents. Bella had a wonderful time, and she enjoyed Noah's company even more. She was falling for him fast, but she kept her cool and followed his lead. She still wasn't sure what he wanted from her. She wondered if he was just having a good time until it was time to go, or was he falling for her? She hoped he was. She was open to dating him. She noticed how friendly he was, how attentive he was to her. She admired his way with strangers. People seemed to gravitate to him, and he handled the attention well. And when a child cried because he lost his balloon, Niles bought him 10, then spent time talking with the mother and the father. Bella couldn't help but think he would make a good husband and father. It was in him naturally, except for Noah can't have no goddamn kids. So how the fuck is that supposed to work? Mm-hmm. I hope you did, child. Buck. Oh, Lord. Lord, Lord, Lord. Hey, Sparkle, welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Niles wanted to spend every moment with Bella, but he was constantly reminded that it was all temporary. They were on day 10, and it no longer felt temporary.
Wait, day 10? She was only supposed to be there for 5 days.
Or did the author forget that they told us that? I don't understand. He was surprised at his attachment to her, how comfortable he felt, how the thought of ending it bothered him, and he hadn't even touched her sexually. They were bonded without the physical, in a way he didn't ever think was possible. Noah texted and called Niles to keep up with the progress, and Niles was less than forthcoming with his attachment to her. He told Noah they had become friends and were mostly talking over the phone, that nothing had happened, but something had happened. The truth was Niles had fallen for her. He was making plans to see her frequently. What started out as a favor had quickly turned into something real and tangible. Deep down, he hoped Noah would relinquish his desires, but Noah continued to show interest. He was still dealing with Gemma and was still calling about Bella to get updates and to hear how their conversations were going. This fucking dummy, why he ain't put Gemma down like the mutt she is? Damn it, man. That's terrible to say, Saki, but fuck that hoe. Damn. Can't she see he don't like her? Niles kept a low profile and continued hanging out with her. Bella asked to go to the condo, but Noah had a key and Niles feared him showing up. He wasn't comfortable with the idea, even though he wanted to take her. He figured it would be more comfortable, but he worried about what she would think when she saw it. He was being modest and downplaying his finances, something Noah suggested originally and something he agreed with, but hiding his wealth was becoming difficult. His condo was too fancy to claim it was just a standard run-of-the-mill place to stay. He finally admitted to her that he did okay financially, but never told her his worth. She believed he was a hard-working financial advisor and that his income was better than average. Just about everything he did and owned were on the higher end of the spectrum, and he made sure to keep it from her. No jewelry, no fancy cars, no lavish spending. And so she believed he was just an ordinary man of ordinary means with a bit of flair for fine clothing. She had no reason not to believe him. He seemed quite open. There was a vulnerable quality about him. She had no reason to question him, no reason to doubt anything he said. One more day. You leave tomorrow, he said, his demeanor changing as he clarified her flight out the next morning. Bella noticed his melancholy mood as she sat across from him at Spago's. She knew he wasn't ready to part. Neither was she. She took a sip of her iced tea and shook her head. Yes, her plane was leaving in the morning, but she wanted more time. She didn't want to leave, but she also didn't want him to spend any more money trying to keep her in Vegas. She still had enough left over, and she instantly had an idea. Why don't I stay a little longer? I can change flights. Change it to one that leaves another day. If you want. I mean, I'd rather be here with you, she said, hoping he wanted her to stay. He lit up with excitement. He hoped she would suggest staying. He wasn't ready for her to go. He still had 2 more days, but hanging out on the strip was taking a chance at discovery. He didn't want to bump into Noah or any of his buddies. Yes, I want you to stay, but with me in my suite. Get your things. Stay until next week. I'll get you another ticket. You live in Manhattan, right? He said. Bella blushed. He was direct. He had a way of making her blush like a teenager in high school. Yes, Manhattan. Oh, okay.
I'll stay with you. Huh? Child, listen. I am up fucking set. Y'all know it be your own good goddamn kin people that do you in dirty, but that's what Noah's dumbass get. Dummy. Child, now you gonna be stuck. You gonna have to marry Fight the Power Gemma or Stick Up the Ass Jody or whatever the fuck that bitch name is. Jody, Julie, whoever. Oh, fuck. That is horrible, y'all. I don't even understand what the fuck is happening right. Oh. Okay. Knock it off. Okay, y'all. Sorry about that. I don't know why my phone is acting stupid. It's my hand hitting the thing. Anyway, Bella laid next to Niles. He held her close. He was a gentleman. Spooning was as far as he tried to go, but Bella wanted to go further. She was still calling him Noah, completely unaware that they had switched roles. He responded to the name, but every time she called him that, it did something to him. He was ready to tell her who he was, that it was his twin who had introduced himself that first day, but Niles was becoming insecure for the first time in his life. He wondered what she would do and then decided against it. It wasn't time. They were still too new, but he knew one thing. If Noah failed to get rid of Gemma and left Bella behind, he could never have her. He hoped Gemma stayed. Wow. Wow. I hope Gemma don't, I hope she leave tomorrow, bitch nigga. How you want your brother's piece of ass, sir? Shiesty. Ugh. That's terrible, y'all. That what the old lady say, that's terrible. That E turns to a U. That's a terrible thing. Child, listen. All right. Child, it's still 31 minutes left in this chapter. I know you fucking lying. Oh, shit. All right. Life was blissful. Bella was in love. Their chemistry was undeniable. He was an awesome man, and she wondered if he was an even more awesome lover. She didn't believe she would get so lucky. There was no way he was. That would make him the total package. No one was that perfect, but she wasn't sure. He seemed to be atypical, too good to be true. Go to sleep, he said, which startled Bella. She thought he was asleep. I am, she said in a low tone. What's wrong? He asked as he rubbed her back. Bella was in a fetal position as he laid behind her. She could feel his manhood react. She closed her eyes. She swallowed hard. This wasn't what a good girl did. It damn sure ain't, nasty heifer. She couldn't desire him. They were still new. They were still getting to know each other, but they had covered a lot of ground, spending each day together with countless hours of talks into the wee hours in the morning. Had them comfortable. Noah moved closer, his rock-hard penis now pressed against her derriere. His breathing increased slightly. Bella looked back at him, then turned away. Niles's hand moved slowly down her back to her waist. He took a deep breath. Bella swallowed again. She wanted him to go further, touch her below the waist, reach around her and touch her there. She could feel his breath on her. I want you so bad, he said. Bella opened her eyes. She reached behind her. She touched him, his erect penis firmly in her hand. She didn't bother to take it out. She held him through the loose pajamas he had on. He opened his eyes. He wanted her. He wanted her right then, but he had to be sure. He didn't want to be aggressive. He was playing for keeps, and he feared turning her off. He sure feared betraying his fucking brother. Why is he not fearing betraying his brother? His brother told him, don't sleep with her, bitch, nigga. Oh.
but he wanted to take his time with her. She was delicate, vulnerable, and he had been a hero to her. He didn't want sex as a thank you for the money he gave her in the envelope. He wanted Bella, her heart, her mind, and her body. He wondered if she just wanted to touch. Some women were into that, sex without sex, and he knew some women liked to check the package. Damn sure do. To see if their future partner was well endowed. He was. He had no worries. But he wondered if she wanted him. He continued to rub his fingers lightly across her back, and she took him in her hand and began to slowly stroke him. And in that moment, he knew she wanted him. He was now free to proceed. His light moans turned Bella on. She began stroking him more vigorously. He placed his mouth on her back and began sucking her skin. The hot air from his mouth turned her on even more. Bella began to moan. She continued moving her hand up and down his shaft. She still had him through his pajama pants. She wanted to feel his skin. She turned around. They could see each other under the lights of the water fountain outside their window. Niles stroked the side of her face. She had seduced him and won his heart, and nothing had happened yet. You know what? I don't want this to be good like that. I really don't. I want it to be fucked up, because why is she in the fucking bed with him and not in the other bedroom? Niles is a dirty bastard, but Noah is a fucking dummy, because he over there still fiddle-faddling around with fight-the-power-ass Gemma instead of getting his bitch back from his Rico Suave-ass brother. Oh, my God. I don't even understand. Like, that is fucking annoying. Let me wet my fucking whistle. It's annoying, y'all. Wait, Naja. Girl. She said, I disagree, bitch. She free game now. Noah playing games. No, ma'am, Naja. No. What about I'm my brother's keeper? He was supposed to be doing a favor for he brother. He's his little brother. Yeah, he didn't have no plans of tagging the brother in, Melly Mel. Not at all. Not. Come on, y'all. Damn, y'all hard, ain't y'all? Lord. Not he can't have all the coochies. Shut up, Buns. Oh, Lord, y'all are silly, yo. I am mad about it. Okay, well, I guess you can't have all the coochies then. I don't want you to think bad of me, she said in a low voice. I won't. How could I? We are meant, Bella. I don't ever want to be without you. I want you to stay with me. Go back home with me, he replied. He wanted her to go back to New York with him. He wasn't ready to end what they had, but she would need to return home at some point, and he couldn't deal with the separation. His mind raced. What if she returned home and forgot about him? What if she got involved with someone else or maybe lost interest? He had to have her. She was the one. Damn, his brother told him that she was the one. Why the fuck? Noah is dumb. You know what? I don't even care. This is crazy. Yeah, he know what type of man his brother is. But y'all, what if the twisty disty is that Noah did that shit on purpose, right? Maybe that's the twisty disty, because maybe if Noah could get Niles to fall in love and settle down, then he'll run the company, and then his daddy will stop bugging him and still get his money and be free to run off with his boyfriend, Khadija. Because I bet you that boy... y'all watch! Oh, now I gotta read it. Okay, because I want y'all to know. True shit. Real spit. I was about to put this fucking shit down, but now I want to know if what I said is true. Right. I think what I want...
Listen, I done rehyped myself up for the book. I'm rehyped. All right. Okay. All right. So now I'm going to sit up a little straighter because a bitch was slumping, slouching, sliding off this motherfucking chair. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. I was like, this is some bullshit. And I knew I should have read the other fucking thing. But now I'm excited again. All right. Come to New York City with me, he said. Bella stared into his eyes. The moment was intense. She didn't want to leave. They were on the same page. Oh, Noah, I want to be with you. I do, but I have to go back home. I own a boutique. I have to check on it. Retrieve my packages from the store next door. Open it up for business. It's new. I have to be there or it won't survive. But I want to be with you, she said. He kissed her passionately. All she needed was to tell him she felt the same. Bella sighed. She felt his emotions. She could see he was serious. She paused. She stopped stroking him. The conversation was serious. What was he asking? She couldn't up and move. She was independent. She had her own life. This was the same thing her ex Brian said before it ended disastrously. They too had moved too fast and she found out he was cheating. She blamed herself for not allowing more time to get to know him, but Noah was different. If he were serious, she would give it a chance. It would be the craziest thing she'd ever done. There would be objections from family and friends, but Bella saw herself with Noah. He was the one, and she was ready to be with him as much as possible. What they had started in Vegas was the tip of the iceberg. She had not tired of him. She needed more. I'll go home and take care of some things, and I will join you in New York if that's what you want, she said. No, I don't want to part. Not yet. I'll go with you, help you, be there for you, and at some point we'll go to New York, he said. Bella's eyes opened wide. She was surprised and happy. It felt right. He was the one. All right, she blushed as she kissed him fervently. Bella continued to look deeply into his eyes. She had an incredible feeling. She was glad he would come with her. She was sure she would miss him while she took care of her business. I have something to tell you. You do? What? He said, smiling and looking at her mouth. She blushed again. This was meant, you and me. I felt it before I came here. I felt something was waiting for me. I didn't know what it was. I felt my life would be changed during this trip. I told Danny. I see now what that change was. It's you. I was supposed to meet you. You're the one, she said. She held him tight as he rolled on top of her and dove his tongue into her mouth. Child, listen. Listen. How is he going to get around people calling him Niles? Is he going to tell her that everybody calls him by his nickname? And his brother's name is, call him by his middle name, that his name is Noah Niles Langston, and that his brother's name is Niles, his name would have to be Niles Noah. So they call him Noah and call him Niles? I don't know, this is stupid. I don't think so. This is going to be crazy, but I'm trying to find out if Noah is a master planner or is he going to be stuck at home being a masturbator because his brother done ranked off with his bitch. All right, anyway, Bella had on panties and his t-shirt. She gently touched his bare chest. He was sexy. His body was amazing. Oh, Noah, she moaned as he pulled her panties to the side. He better tell her the truth, because why don't he tell her, yeah, you know, me and my brother, whenever we go out of town, we use each other's name, right? So, like, it's kind of like a little trick or whatever. How about that part? You know what I'm saying? Yes, ma'am, church lady. Yes, ma'am, church lady. You had something you wanted to say, church lady? Is it something I need to see, church lady?
Am I going to rewind the tape and see something? That's what you're trying to say? All right, I'm going to get back to the book. He was just calling my name. You trying to make sure I was paying attention? I see you. All right. Bella squirmed in anticipation. He looked deep into her eyes. His gaze never waned. You're mine. I'll love you with all my heart. Never forget that. Anything you need, you ask. Do you understand me, Bella? He said, his voice serious. She smiled. He was already everything she needed. Yes. He kissed her patently and held her panties to the side as he entered her. Bella jumped. She let out a loud moan. He took his time. Bella hadn't had sex in a while. She wasn't prepared for him. Niles was huge and she jumped every time he advanced further. You want me to stop? He said in her ear. No, she said in a soft voice. He was better than good. He was awesome. His slow yet methodical entry had her ready to scratch the walls. Niles stopped once he was completely inside her. He relished the moment. She felt like a warm cloth wrapped tight. He kissed her slowly, then began pounding her fiercely. Bella's mouth opened as she tried taking him. The feeling was unbelievable. Her eyes teared up. His touch, his words, the moment were all encompassing, and she could hardly contain herself. There was nothing to do but moan and cry. Her tears were tears of happiness. He could feel her pulling away and slowed his movements. No, give me you, she said. She wanted him to make love to her the way he liked to make love. If it became too much, she would be more aggressive in telling him it hurt. But for the moment, it was a pain pleasure that was sensational. He slowed, then stopped and began kissing and lightly sucking her lips. He stared into her eyes. He was overwhelmed with his feelings. He had fallen in love before they even made love. And now that he was inside her, his fate was sealed, but Bella wasn't his. He wasn't supposed to indulge himself with her. Noah specifically asked him to charm and seduce without bedding her, and he had failed miserably. He had just begun. He planned on making love to her multiple times throughout the night. Niles entered her again and picked up the pace once he was completely inside her. Bella moaned and arched her back slightly. She opened her legs wider. She wanted all of him. He increased his speed and cupped her ass as he went deep. Bella held him as he planted his face in her neck. He kissed her neck slowly at first, then sucked with an intense pressure as he continued pounding inside her. She moaned loudly. He was intense. His dick filled her up completely. She opened her mouth slightly as she felt herself coming. Niles could tell she was. He felt a warm sensation as he continued. He grunted as Bella matched him with passion and desire. He closed his eyes. Her tight, warm pussy had him in a nice, firm grip. He was totally under her spell. Niles knew he was in trouble. Bella was everything he ever wanted, and the addition of the best sex he experienced did not help. Damn, Bella, he said as he tried to control his heart. She was Noah's girl, something he tried telling himself over and over, but the moment was his. Noah couldn't take that away. He still hoped Noah patched things up with Gemma, or at least was unsuccessful in getting away from her. You're taking my last name. Your name is Bella Langston. You hear me? He said in her ear as he prepared to come inside her. It was a rare moment for him. He usually wore condoms, but this was his first love, first real bond. Bella smiled at the thought. Intense passions had her in its grasp. She let out a series of moans. The lights from the water show put a romantic ambiance on their incredible evening. You have people calling me that already since the first day we met, she said. Niles looked at her, his strokes still powerful. He sucked her neck, then looked in her eyes again. Bella was emotional. She wondered why that was, why he called her Mrs. Langston and didn't even know her. Tell me, why did you have people calling me Mrs. Langston that very first day? She wanted to hear him say it, that he knew it immediately, that he knew it before she did, that she was under stress and didn't feel a connection had been made almost immediately. He slowed, then stopped, still inside her. Bella closed her eyes. His penis was throbbing. It felt sensational. She opened her eyes and looked deeply into his. He rubbed her face. His answer to her question, he thought, was obvious. Because you are. You will be, he replied, never taking his eyes off of her. Bella got all emotional. Yes, I am. And yes, I will. Niles awoke in the middle of the night. He could feel Bella's side of the bed, then jolted up. She was gone. He panicked. Shit, he said as he jumped up and ran out of the room. Bella looked back at him, then looked out the window. She appeared to be in deep thought. Niles approached her slowly. His breathing calmed as he saw she wasn't gone. She was half-dressed. She had her bra on and the skirt that she had on earlier that day. Niles looked her up and down. He approached from behind and stood close to her. He smelled her. He closed his eyes. She hoped she wasn't he hoped she wasn't leaving. And he prayed she wasn't ending their night. What's wrong? He asked. Bella wiped her eyes and shook her head. I don't know. I'm afraid. I've never felt this way about anybody so fast. We hardly know one another. I can't be this intense with someone I just met, she said, wiping a tear from her eye. Niles held her from behind and after a few seconds turned her around to face him. He held her face. He moved her hair out of his way. He wiped a single tear as it rolled down her cheek. Bella looked in his eyes. It was dark, but the lights from outside had their faces illuminated. Niles stared intensely at her. He didn't say a word. He didn't have to. Bella could see his pain, and after a brief and highly intense moment, he spoke. Listen. I know you're scared. So am I. But I love you, and I know you love me. We can't help how fast it happened. That doesn't make it any less real. There's something I have to tell you. I can't tell you now. It's too early. Just know that I love you, and if you leave now, you'll be turning your back on us. Don't be afraid, Bella. You told me this was meant, that you felt something was waiting for you here. It was me. I'm here. I can't lose you. I waited my whole life for you. I've searched for this feeling. I wasn't sure what it would feel like and if I would even recognize it. All I knew was it was something I was sure I wouldn't want to live without, and I finally found you, he said. Bella touched his face. She was no longer afraid. He said everything she needed to hear. Oh, Noah, she said as she embraced him. She placed her lips on his and held it there. She breathed it into his mouth as he kept it open in anticipation of her warm, wet tongue. Niles pushed her against the window and lifted her legs. He held her as she reached down and grabbed him. She was anxious for him to be inside her. She put him on the tip of her opening and let him do the rest. She moaned when he pushed inside, a deep and intense moan. She looked at him again. A tear rolled down her face, tears of joy that she allowed to make their journey down her cheeks. She made no effort to wipe them away. She wanted him to know he had her. She wanted him to see the tears that were a symbol of how she felt about him. She smiled, then dropped her head back as he began slowly moving her body up and down on him. Soon, he carried her to the couch and looked down at her body. He could see her shaved and beautifully manicured pussy. He laid on her, then descended down her body. Bella began to shake. Each kiss he planted on her caused her to tremble. She held his head. Bella felt herself becoming lightheaded. She wanted his mouth on her. His kisses were powerful. She imagined him being good at it. You belong to me, Bella. Don't try to leave. You're mine forever. I'll always love you. You hear me? Bella slowly shook her head. Say it. I'm yours forever, she said. And with those words, Niles plunged his tongue inside her and used his mouth to bring her the greatest feeling she had ever felt. He was a skilled lover, but Bella wasn't prepared for his mouth. Her moans were loud. Her body gave in immediately as she felt the waves of her orgasm coming down. Noah, wait. No, baby, wait, she said. Niles ignored her pleas and continued manipulating her and sucking her until she was powerless. Her body shook as she came, her back arched, her legs clamping his head. Bella held his head tight, pushing him into her as she moaned with each vibration.
vibration. She released him and laid staring at the ceiling, breathing heavily. Shock had her quiet and reflective. Niles came up to her face and she kissed him. He laid on her. He played in her hair as he gave her time to recoup. He wasn't done, and Bella was ready to please him. He hadn't come yet. She flipped over and got on her hands and knees. Niles smiled. This was his favorite position, and he hadn't asked her. He took a moment to admire the vein, then entered her from behind. Oh, sorry, the view, not the vein. My ass is cockeyed. He moaned loudly as he pounded fiercely inside her. He planned on making love to her the rest of the morning hours. He didn't have much time. Noah was coming, and he was already missing her. The sun shined brightly, waking Niles up. He felt for his watch, then adjusted his eyes and looked at the time. He set his watch back down and glanced over at Bella. She was still in a deep sleep. Her hair tossed wildly over her face. Niles eased out of the bed and walked slowly out of the room. He glanced back before he exited. She hadn't moved. She was exhausted. He was merciless in his love for her. They had made love 4 times. He wouldn't mind being in her again. Today was the day. He made a cup of coffee, then stared out the window. He sipped as he reflected on their brief but intense time together. Anxiety soon overwhelmed him. Pause. What if this nigga know that he can't make a baby with Bella, but he want her so bad that he knew Niles was a tricky dick ass nigga and that he would fuck her and get her pregnated, and then Noah's gonna swoop in because, yeah. And now she thinks she pregnated by Noah for real. And that then his father would be okay with Noah marrying Bella. And not that Judy, Jody, Julie, whatever the fuck her name is, bitch. Ha, you motherfucker! That's what it is, y'all. He found the perfect way to get his daddy out of his business. Yo! Nigga! That's what it is. He like, yep, I get to be with a bitch I can be with and see myself with, and my daddy gonna think that I got a baby. So he won't force me. Oh, okay. All right, let me be quiet because it's still 16 minutes in this chapter, and I'm gonna get the fuck out of here because, yeah, y'all done had me up here. Lord, listen. Bella was his, and yet he was waiting on his brother to arrive. A game was played that felt nothing like a game. Seducing Bella was a bad idea that had just gotten worse. He had fallen in love with her. In a little over a week, she had stolen his heart, and he was a better man with her. It was dangerous from the start. Niles was experienced enough to know love didn't wait for permission. It could show up at any time, usually when one least expected it. Bella made him want to do better. She had him completely. He thought of no one else. All past lovers seemed less important. He noticed no one but her on their dates and sightseeing adventures. Yeah, Miss Bella got that old... yeah, right. They don't see nobody, child. Nobody. Part of him wanted to call Noah and tell him he couldn't leave her, that they were crazy about one another and it was too late. He wanted to apologize to his brother, but he couldn't tell his brother to back off. Noah talked of nothing else. He spent his last days frantically trying to get Gemma to return to New York without him. And he was finally successful. Niles watched the clock. He wanted to go back into the room and lay on Bella, kiss her and enter her, make love to her one final time. Niles stood there looking down at the street. The distance made the people appear small, like ants. He couldn't help but think about how meaningless life was without someone you loved to share it with. He never imagined Bella would capture his heart so quickly. He wanted to stay with her, but he had worn out his welcome. He was supposed to take her out and get her opened and vulnerable, but one evening turned into several nights as he continually reported to Noah that she was distant and that their time was reduced to calls, a lie he hoped would get Noah uninterested in her so he could continue to see her. But Noah was pressing on. He was still just as interested in Bella as the day he saw her on the plane, and he was coming to claim her. Noah had called Niles several times.
He then sent texts. One in particular had Niles upset, a message asking if he had slept with her that he ignored, but Niles was torn. This was his brother, his twin. They had never gotten into any disagreements over women. He was only supposed to seduce her. Noah had specifically asked him to keep the courtship platonic, and now he would need to confess. Noah was smitten with her and had stepped over the line. Things were complicated, to say the least. He had fallen in love. Niles was happy he had a chance to be with Bella. He had not known of the feelings inside of him, so many times when women got too close, she got the wrong close or two in there. When women got too close, there you go, he found a way to end it. But he wanted love. He was a romantic at heart. Love seemed fleeting, but this was different, and Noah probably sensed it. The reason behind his frantic desperation to get Gemma to leave, something he finally worked out with a lie. He told her that his father called in a favor and he was to meet a man about leasing a space, a huge lie that worked. Gemma boarded her plane as Noah waved by, and now he was on his way. A light knock on the door signified the end. Niles sighed. He sat his coffee down and walked slowly to the door. This is crazy. I can't do this. I love her, he thought. As he turned the knob, he opened the door and stepped out into the hall. Noah looked upset. He had regretted getting Niles involved. He could see in his eyes something had occurred. You slept with her, didn't you? You haven't returned one call or text in 3 days, he criticized. Niles peeked in. Lower your voice. She's asleep. I asked if you slept with her, Noah repeated. Niles looked down and shook his head. Yes. Oh, thank God, he told him the truth. Oh, thank God. I did not want him to lie, child. Right, brother. I blew her back out. Oh, my God. Okay. Noah took a deep breath. He didn't want to appear angry. He was the one who set the whole thing in motion. He was the reason Niles was in Vegas. He was the one who asked for help in getting Bella, and he was the one unable to fulfill his end of the bargain because he had an out-of-control ex-girlfriend to deal with. I'm afraid to ask the details. You weren't supposed to. Remember that part, Noah fumed. Look, don't. Niles said before stopping and calming himself. I think I'm going to fly back early. I have business to take care of. I would stay, but I'm sure you can take it from here, he said as he slowly opened the door. Niles had already packed his bags and sat them near the door. He reached inside and grabbed them. He walked towards the elevator as Noah stood. He never looked back. He was hurt. He expected Noah to give up wanting her. He wasn't sure if it was just a sexual desire or if Noah really had a thing for her. He hoped it wasn't purely sexual. He would not forgive him if it was. He had a broken heart, and it seemed unfair if it were because of some sexual desires his brother was looking to satisfy. Noah watched Niles get on the elevator. He was surprised to see him so affected. Wasn't like him. He never got close to a woman. He had too many of them to fall for one of them, but he was hurt, even though he tried not to appear that way. They were twins. They knew everything about one another. He could always read his brother's moods easily, and he could see Niles had fallen for Bella. Noah walked into the suite. He set his bag down and walked to the door. Bella lay sleeping, her naked body partially exposed. Noah couldn't help the anger he felt. He pictured Niles enjoying her. He blamed himself for what he was now feeling, but Gemma was gone, and Noah had no plans to leave until he saw where Bella was with her plans. He hoped to have a few days with her. It was necessary. Nothing had changed for him. He still wanted her. But see, fucking old boy didn't tell him, hey, I told her that I would to come back to New York with me and that I would help. I would go back to her spot with her. But I bet you, I don't know. Here we go. Bella woke to the sound of a door closing. She sat up and stretched her arms, then grabbed her robe and got out of bed. Who was that, babe? She said as she exited the room. She covered her mouth and blushed when she saw the fabulous breakfast he had ordered for them. Oh, honey, she gushed as she ran to him and kissed him. Bella stepped back and looked him up and down. Why are you dressed? They didn't bring it up? She asked curiously. Yeah, they did. I ran down to the front desk to pay for a few more days, he replied. She sat down and placed her napkin over her lap. Noah exited the bathroom and immediately walked up to her. She sat at the small yet intimate portable table provided by the hotel. you look beautiful, he said, then sat across from her. He placed his napkin in his lap and took the lids off of the trays. Bella smiled at the delicious spread of pancakes, scrambled eggs, turkey sausage, and hash browns. Pause. What if one twin's a lefty and the other's a righty and she happened to notice? What are you gonna lie and tell her he's ambidextrous? This looks good, honey. Thank you, Bella said. You're welcome. You want to do anything special today, or we can stay in? He asked. Bella thought for a moment. Did you find out if your friends were still here? I'm sure my presence messed up their trip. They want to see you, too. This is supposed to be your birthday trip, she replied. Noah frowned. What? My birthday was weeks ago. I want to be with you. They're good. I've known them over 10 years. I'm good. I would rather be with you. So, on second thought, I'll tell them I'm tied up, like, literally, babe. You should tie me up tonight, he laughed. Bella broke into laughter. She hadn't heard him crack jokes. Noah was usually more serious, but in a sensual and charismatic kind of way. His timing was perfect, though. Bella chuckled. Sure, hon. I'll need rope, chains, and a whip. Child, listen, fuck around and get what you ask for. I mean, I don't want that. I'm the one want to be tied up. It's going to be a little strange for me if I got to tie you up. I don't want that. Oh, Lord, I wonder why whatchacallit didn't tell her that he told her he was keeping her and going to her spot or whatever. Girl, I see you. She tell me, oh, I thought she was talking about something else. Right, Cupcake. She gonna be like, say, man. And then when they meet at the family dinner and shit, right? Boom. She gonna be like, bruh, why am I magnetically attracted to your damn bruh? Like, because their energy got to be different, y'all. Their energy has to be different. I don't know. I'm thinking that she should be able to tell that the energy is different. Well, she already noticing now little things like, you know, one is serious and the other is a jokey joke ass nigga. All right, let me shut the fuck up because it's 9 minutes left in this chapter and I got to go. Hell, I was supposed to been fucking gone. I love y'all. I must love y'all. The fuck? I should have just ended. Anyway, and y'all sitting here just soaking it up. Girl, that's what the spreaders is made for, chat. Sorry. Let me be quiet. Noah and Bella were unable to part ways. They spent time seeing more of Vegas. Bella spoke with her friend Chrissy about finding her prince charming in her nightmare of a trip with Danny. Girl, you've been there a month. What the hell, Bella? This is crazy. Bring your ass back home. Tell him bye. Doesn't he stay in New York City? That's practically around the block. You can visit him here. What are you doing? Are you moving there? She complained. Bella listened to her go on and on. She knew her friend was just being cautious. No, silly, we're not ready to come home, but we will be ready soon, I guess. I'm coming home soon. Things have slowed down. I'm ready. I don't know, she replied, sounding confused and unsure. Uh-oh, what was that? Chrissy said, sensing something in her voice. Nothing. It's just that he seems different lately. When we first met, he was everything I could ever want. We meshed well together. It was exciting. He made me feel a certain way. I can't even explain it. And he made me want him. I couldn't get enough. And sexually, it was insane. But now, I don't know. At some point, he changed, she said. Chrissy shook her head. She felt they were moving too fast. Changed. How? See, Bella, you don't know him. Just come home. You need to get to know him slowly. Take breaks away from him. See if you miss him. Give it a chance to grow slowly, naturally. Bella held the phone. She wasn't ready to part. She wanted the old him back. I just goddamn motherfucking shitting ass said it. Indeed. Stay out of my goddamn business, buns. Stay out of my business, gal. Child, listen, whatever, okay?
She figured he was just tired. They were making love all night, most nights, and was up during the day. No, I can't. I know we move fast, but I can't just leave. We were talking marriage, kids. I don't want to leave. We made a commitment, and I love him. The women stayed on the phone speaking about Noah for hours. Bella told Chrissy that even the sex with Noah felt different, that it was still good, but it was amazing before. Ooh-wee! Oh, my God, today. Child. I don't know what this here about to turn into. He need to learn how to stroke like his brother. Wifey talking about, see, Noah got that whack. That's why nobody want his ass. Girl, Gemma want the fuck out of him with her masculine ass. Gemma said, don't be talking about her man, bitch. Don't be talking about her man. That's her man. Oh, my God. Lord have mercy. Mm-mm. I don't even know what to say. Poor her. She stated he had gotten lazy in the bedroom, that he used to do more, give more, was more intense and passionate, and that he used to bring her to orgasm effortlessly. But that had changed. He seemed to be going through the motions, and she was having less orgasms. Oh, hell no. Put that nigga on the first fucking thing, smoking. I ain't joking. What the fuck? Oh, my God. How you gonna fucking give me no life and then take it back? Shit, no. Chrissy wasn't sure what to make of Bella's complaints. She had never heard of someone having such drastic changes in their personality and in their sexual behaviors. She worried about Bella, but Bella was adamant about staying. She was certain they were meant to be, and she was in it for the long haul. It's another break in the goddamn chapter. But at least it's only 6 minutes. Oh, Lord. I want to know. Okay, Smokey, I see how you doing it. Because you know what? Wifey said that pain hot garbage. What the hell? Oh, my God. I cannot. Okay, Niles, you're right. Well, I mean, because she could still go back to Niles because girl, wait, what if it ended that they both decide to just share her and she just they agree to help Noah out, right? And then Niles, you know, I don't know how they worked that out, but I tell you what, child, listen. We could get a three flat, you heard me? And I live in the middle. One come downstairs, one come upstairs. Catch. Anyway, back to the book. Noah and Bella had been in Vegas a month. They felt as though they lived there. Noah was worldly, and he had the finances to support staying there as long as he wished. But Bella had a business to run. Her mother, Connie, had been opening her store daily and keeping tabs of what she needed to order. Bella told her mother she met a man and had fallen in love. Connie supported her daughter, but worried. She knew her daughter was level-headed. She wanted Bella happy, and she appeared to be. Bella still was. Noah wasn't doing anything that caused her to want to leave. He just wasn't being himself, and the differences were noted. In the meantime, Bella continued in her relationship with him. She still wanted him, all the while hoping to feel that special feeling she once had. She blamed herself. Maybe she was getting cold feet, looking for an excuse to part ways. Noah sat on the couch looking out of the window as he took time to check his stocks and investments. Bella plopped down next to him, and the two took care of their personal business together. Bella went online to order items her mother told her were out of stock. She searched for replacements and ordered new tops and pants. She used money she still had to pay for the merchandise. Noah was generous with her, and when she ran low, he gave her more. Bella closed her laptop and laid her head on his shoulder. All right, fuck around, child, and decades will pass. She watched as he changed the amounts of some of his investments. Noah talked her through it, teaching her about stocks and how to trade online. Bella was proud of him. He was a lot smarter than she originally thought. She had no idea he was a whiz at something that seemed so complicated.
There was still a lot to learn about the new love of her life. He didn't talk in depth about his family life. Bella noticed he gave vague responses with regard to his parents and siblings. She wasn't sure what to make of it. And when he didn't seem stressed about it, she let it go. She figured she had time and she would meet them one day and get to know them on her own. He seemed to touch the surface on every subject, which wasn't at all how he was in the beginning of their relationship. He used to be an intense and deeply feeling person. Now he was more laid back. Bella wondered if he were tiring of the relationship. She was confused. He told her about his professional life and how he held 2 degrees. He spoke about his year-long relationship that had ended. He told her about his controlling father and overly attached mother, that their smothering ways had pushed him away. Bella felt bad for him. She didn't know what it was like to not want to be around your parents. Noah told her very little in the way of factual details. He left out the fact that his father was rich or the name of the company he owned, and the fact that he was a twin. Noah sensed Bella had strong family ties and he feared her being turned off. He decided he would tell her when the time was right, that for the time being, he would do everything he could to keep her happy. And Niles had told him that he discussed nothing about family other than his mother, father, brother, and sister were alive and well and living in New York, which was just as he instructed. Oh, now the bitch nigga wanna follow directions and shit, right? Right. Now, instead of keeping his dick to himself, he didn't follow that fucking direction, though, right? Now this bitch finna find out she pregnant. Oh, of that I'm fucking sure. While he pumping and dumping and dipping and letting his twin brother be slipping. Right, this is some bullshit. Oh, my God. But I need to know how it's gonna end because, oh, my God. All right. Noah wondered how much she knew. He had tried to contact Niles despite multiple attempts. Proof his brother was angry and obviously in love with Bella. Several more days passed. Stephen had returned home and had flown back at Noah's request. Noah had asked him to stay. Stephen didn't mind since he had struck up a romance with a waitress at the Mirage. Stephen was glad to be there for his friend. He could see Noah was in love. Noah had something to do. He wanted Stephen there for support. He paid all Stephen's tabs and made his stay comfortable. He needed just one more night, and he set the plan in motion. He made reservations at Prime, which was ironically the same restaurant Niles had taken her to on their first date. Noah was in love. He understood Niles's anger. Bella was phenomenal. He himself had fallen hard for her. He was head over heels in love, and his own fears set in. He had never loved a woman practically overnight, but he decided he would take a risk. Bella made him happier than anyone had ever made him. She felt right. Their chemistry was magnetic, and he wasn't leaving without her. Part of him felt a need to secure what they had. He felt Niles on his heels. He didn't believe his brother would be able to just dismiss what he had, and so he would make them official. Bella sat across from Noah. She ate slowly, looking curiously at him. He'd been acting strange the past couple of days, different from what she thought she knew. He was dressed different, smelled different, his conversations, not what they normally spoke about. Sex was different. It felt different. He didn't moan the same, didn't look at her the same, didn't do special things anymore. Gone was his mouth on her, and she wondered why. Oh, Noah don't eat cootie cat. Ooh, hell no. Now listen, let me explain something to you. Unless you're gonna give me the freedom to go out and pay another sucker to, you know, sip on a little scissor. Although jelly's so much messier. Anyway, the whole idea is that unless you're going... Unless you're going to allow me to... I got to be... Sir, understand something. That's like asking me to not brush my teeth. Like, it's not going to happen. No, hell no. So you're going to have to let me go to the dentist every once in a while then. You know what I'm saying? Because I ain't going to, No.
And I promise it'll just be a quick little checkup. And you're not coming right back home to your ass. Shh. Listen. I don't know, bro. This nigga's loaded. Y'all baby shit. Okay, be with broke ass Ray Ray who eat pussy real good. Go ahead. I'll wave from my Rolls Royce. This nigga's caked the fuck up, okay? I just said he gonna let you go out every once in a while, okay? He gonna let you do that. Now, what's you complaining about? That's all I'm saying. All right. Bella wondered why things seemed odd. She made excuses for him. They were getting to know one another on a deeper level, and she wondered if he wasn't just complicated. She looked over and noticed Stephen a few tables over. Honey, did you know Stephen was coming? Why isn't he and his date sitting with us? Noah shrugged his shoulders. Okay, baby, what's up? She asked. Noah smirked. He couldn't contain himself, and he couldn't help but be excited. Ma'am, the waiter said as he placed a glass of champagne in front of her. Sir, he said, sitting another glass down for Noah. Bella stared at the thin, tall glass. She admired the beauty of it. The etchings and carvings were of a man and woman, a limited edition Lalique crystal flute purchased by Noah and given to the waiter. Bella glanced over at Stephen. He and his date looked away. Bella looked back at Noah. He looked at her champagne, then picked the glass up. She looked at it. Something in it caught her eye. She looked down in her glass and placed her hand over her heart. Oh, Noah, what is this? She said, tears rolling down her cheeks. I want you to marry me. Not next month or next year. I want you to marry me now, he said, as he stood up and poured the champagne in her half-full water glass. He removed the ring and got down on one knee. Bella looked around, then put her hand over her face. The moment was overwhelming. Noah removed her hands, then smiled at the guests as people clapped. Bella smiled at him, her attention now only on him. What was initially slightly embarrassing was now a tender moment between her and the man she loved. Bella Marie Bradley, will you marry me? Bella leaned forward and shook her head yes as she grabbed his face. She kissed him sweet and tenderly. I didn't think we'd last. Because it just says, I didn't we'd last. I didn't think you wanted to marry. I thought things had changed for you. You've been so different lately, and I thought we were drifting apart. Yes, I'll marry you. I love you, she said in a low tone as she looked deeply into his eyes. She glanced around. It was overwhelming. She was so swept in the moment she had forgotten they had company. The restaurant was filled. People applauded. Bella blushed. They were witnessing the beginning of her love affair. It was wonderful, and she was ready to start a life with him. And that's the end of that chapter, child. Finally. All right, y'all. This was fun. Yes, I had a wonderful, wonderful time. I hope y'all did, too. Thank y'all for letting me read out loud to you, honey. I appreciate each and every one of you. Thank you so much, Love Jones, for all of your wonderful help, child. Let me see something. Hold on, child. Okay, so Love Jones was being slick and flip of the lip, huh? Okay. I gotcha. Right, and you wanted to stop. I saw you. It's all right, though. It's quite all right. It's all right. Okay, so what the hell? This girl talking about I need HEADOM to the G. Hey, Kay. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Welcome, welcome. Child, listen. Wait a minute. There you go. All right, y'all. I'm out of here. This was fun. Thank each and every one of y'all. I truly, truly appreciate you. Thank you again, Sean, for the tip, boo-boo. I appreciate you. All right, listen, y'all. I don't know for certain if I'm gonna come over here tomorrow. Yeah, I don't know exactly what I'm gonna do. So if you see me, then you see me. And if you don't, then you don't. Okay? Okay. All right? So listen, y'all have a good night. All right? Enjoy, enjoy, enjoy. Please be safe. Use protection to those of you that will be engaging in, you know, specific types of behavior. Don't come back around to this motherfucker with no damn babies. Okay? All right. I love y'all. Y'all be careful. And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye y'all. What y'all still doing here? I done let the music play all the way out and it say it's still 22 people in the building. Do I have to start busting caps up in here for y'all to leave? Lord, 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 Lord. So y'all just gonna sit there all quiet and shit? Get it ready for me. And, yeah. Y'all so damn silly. Y'all go. I know, reading the comments, right? Stop reading the comments. Yes, I'm cutting the lights off. Not Naja gonna get pregnant, child. Demisha gonna end up pregnated. Child, listen. She talking about all shit like Lawrence Fishburne in The Color Purple. I'm out. Lord, Melly Mel, she bet not get pregnant. Mm-mm. I promise you, she bet not let her come back here pregnated and sit on her. I'm going to kick the lining out of her ass. That's what I'm going to do. The whole damn lining. Lord, have mercy. No babies. Mm-mm. Hell, no, that's not good. All right, y'all get on away from around here, okay? Love Jones, where you at with the good night and the thanks for coming out? We'll see you next week, ass fucking thang-a-lang, girl. She was in here at first. Now she done dipped out. I know where she at. All right, that's where... Listen, that's where she at. Ain't doing what she's supposed to be doing over here. Mm-hmm. Anyway, all right, I love y'all. Bye.